CBS Sports kicks off its third season. Over the past 2 years, we've brought you the color, emotion, and spirit of the game. And our team is ready to bring you the best in college sports, the best in college football. Don James brings his Washington Huskies into Michigan Stadium to face 105,000 partisan Wolverine fans and their leader, the legendary Bo Schembechler. Schembechler's a motivator, a teacher, and his theme is always the same.
The team.
Today, it's the Washington Huskies against the third-ranked Michigan Wolverines as CBS Sports kicks off year three of its coverage of college football.
CBS Sports presents College Football. Today's game is sponsored by Chevrolet, with performance, style, innovation, quality, and the value that make up today's Chevrolet. GMAC, the financing people from General Motors. And by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts.
For the 55th straight game, a crowd in excess of 100,000 is here for today's clash between Washington and Michigan. And we just have ideal weather conditions for our first game of this season. Hi, everybody. I'm Gary Bender. We're excited about year three of college football on CBS. And with me, my friend, my broadcasting partner, who helped describe the action this season, Pat Heaton. Matt, we have two similar teams. They're in the same boat.
Well, they both won last week with new quarterbacks and good defense. Now, expect both these teams to pound the football right at you and have that defensive come after you kind of philosophy.
Now, we're going to further analyze these two clubs, but one of the great traditions in Big Ten football, the bands. Today, the University of Michigan marching band. Football is back on CBS, as college football on CBS will continue after this commercial message and a word from your local station. Michigan Stadium, Ann Arbor, Michigan. The Washington Huskies are on the field. They shut out Northwestern last week, 26-0, and Don James has directed the Huskies to either a first or second place finish in the Pac-10 each of the last 7 years. Two teams very similar, not only from the coaching standpoint, but from an offensive philosophy, and also at quarterback, Pat. Two inexperienced quarterbacks. First for Washington, Hugh Millen. He is a walk-on from a junior college.
And he has a very strong right arm, and he did all that was asked of him last week in helping his team win. But the problem was, not much was asked of him. His defense really won the football game. Don James is asking a lot more of him today against Michigan.
Now, Michigan has Jim Harbaugh. He is the son of a coach who's the coach at Western Michigan. He played out in Palo Alto for a couple of years. Last year, he was a third-string quarterback.
And you have to like Harbaugh. He comes in his very first game, 100,000 people, playing against the number one team in the nation. Bernie Kosar is on the other side of the field, yet he leads his team to a win. He's an emotional leader. As a matter of fact, after last week's game, he ran up to Bo and shook Bo and said, "Bo, I'm going to play better next week." Bo said, "You better."
As far as similarities offensively, both teams really will use the tailbacks extensively. But before we talk further about that, everybody awaiting the arrival of the Wolverines of Michigan as this crowd in excess of 100,000. This is a special place for football. This is the largest owned college structure in the nation. And each year, Michigan has led the nation in attendance. And you can see the Wolverines. Under the direction of Bo Schembechler, his 16th year, the Dean of Big Ten Coaches, and here they come. top-ranked Miami 22-14 last week, ending the nation's longest winning streak at 13 games, ranked third in the country. And Bo Schembechler has won or tied for the Big Ten title 10 times. Now, Pat, let's talk some football a little bit here. We have the tailbacks as a real story today, and I want you to tell us a little bit about what we'll expect both for Michigan and Washington.
Well, both teams are similar. They're both tailback-dominated offense, but there's the man, Gerald White, number 22, from Titusville, Florida. Now, Michigan's base play is a play called the bounce play. It gives him three separate options. Now, what he has to do is watch the block of the tight end on the defensive end. If he kicks that defensive end out to the right, then the bounce play becomes an off-tackle play. The tailback will take the ball, follow the block of the tight end, run, make it an inside running play. Now, if that tight end hooks the defensive end to the left of the screen, then the next important block is the fullback on the strong safety. If that fullback kicks that strong safety out to the right, then the tailback will follow that block and cut off that. Otherwise, he'll hook the strong safety to the left and bounce the play outside for a big gain.
Pat, you talked about Gerald White, but they have Rick Rogers, they have Jamie Morris. On the other hand, Washington alternate Jackson and Robinson. The two of the last three meetings between these two clubs have been to the Rose Bowl, and today it should be a good one. Washington, Michigan. Michigan has won the toss. However, they have waved off the decision. As an end result, Washington will receive the football. This is Todd Slopey, number 99, who will be kicking off with a barefoot. Danny Green and Lonzell Hill back as the twin receivers for the Huskies. And we're underway. Lonzell Hill will let it hit, go out of the back of the end zone, and they'll set it up at the 20-yard line. Offensively, let's look at the Washington Huskies. Hugh Millen, we mentioned, he is a junior college walk-on. Last year ran the scout squad. Wald Hunt, the veteran fullback, an outstanding blocker. Ron Jackson led him in rushing last week against Northwestern. And Danny Green, he's the big play performer. And Mark Pattison, the route runner, the man with the sure hands. And Rod Jones, after two seasons of injury, getting a starting nod at tight end. Now, we have one change defensively we want to set for Michigan. Al Cinchich, their all Big Ten nose guard, had back problems. He's not starting the game. Joe Gray instead is in there. From the 20. Danny Green in motion. This is Jackson. And Jackson goes nowhere because of Kevin Brooks, number 52. Now the offensive line for Washington. They're having to rebuild, losing a couple of outstanding players. Dennis Mahar, an outstanding academician. Al Robertson, his dad, played at Stanford in 51. Ernesty, an honorable mention Pac-10 performer. Doug Crow at the right guard spot. And a right tackle, this is the biggest man in the Pac-10. Kevin Gogan, who weighs about 290 pounds. There's Millen's stats from last week against Northwestern. But as Pat said, they're going to have to call on him to do more today. Second down, 10 and a half. Jackson again, and Jackson out to the 24. Mike Hammerstein, 66, made the stop. Now, let's look defensively at Michigan. There's Jim Scarcelli. They want him to just relax a little bit. He was nervous last week. Hammerstein, one of seven brother acts on this team, and this is the guy that's not starting. He was in great pain yesterday. Instead, it's Gray and Kevin Brooks, the All-American candidate. Rodney Lyles with three interceptions last week. And Don James, the dean of the Pac-10 coaches. Third down, 6 for Washington. Beautiful protection. And Danny Green, who dropped a couple of passes last week, Pat, couldn't hang on there.
Well, you're precisely right. He had some problems last week hanging onto the football. But Hugh Millen threw that ball awfully hard for Danny Green. Remember, it was only a 6-yard gain they needed for the first down. And he was open and threw the ball well, but perhaps a little bit too hard.
That was Cockett, number 30, who defended on the play. And Tony Gant, 14, will go back to receive this punt. Gant out of Fremont, Ohio, was an outstanding running back in high school. And Thane Cleland. There's his average last week, kicking in Husky Stadium. He hit it well. Gant inside the 30-yard line. He'll make it to the 35. We have a penalty flag at the 46-yard line. That was a 47-yard kick that time by Cleveland and a 6-yard return.
You mean 47-yard punt?
That's one of your pet peeves. You always want to call it punts.
They're punters. We have a punter and we have a kicker.
Otho Courts from Oakland, Illinois, the referee. We have a clipping. Clipping against Michigan, so they will not start where they wanted to. Let's look now while we have this opportunity to look at the Michigan offense. At quarterback, Jim Harbaugh, his dad now the head coach at Western Michigan. Bob Perryman had three touchdowns last week. Gerald White led him in rushing with 89 yards. And Steve Johnson, he along with another Johnson, the alternating at wide receiver. And Vince Bean, Sim Nelson, considered to be the best returning tight end in the Big Ten. So the penalty sets Michigan at the 20-yard line, and Jim Harbaugh in to run the team. The two interceptions, one of those last week was a deflected pass. Gerald White, and White, 4 yards, and you can see the white shirts arrive and push him back. The offensive line in Michigan, the biggest concern for Bo Schembechler. Clay Miller, possibly their best player now for Norman, Oklahoma. Bob Tabaccino. Art Bellardos trying to replace the All-American Tom Dixon. Doug James, who was a tackle last year, now at the guard spot. Mark Hammerstein, his brother Mike starting on defense, and Mark at offensive tackle. Giovanni Johnson now has come in at a wide receiver. White and Perryman, the running backs. Second down and 6. White has a first down. 10 people's number 26 made the stop. The first down run, let's look at it.
We talked about the bounce play early in the football game. Again, they're going to give the ball to Gerald White and let him just read the blocks. He picks up a nice block by his guard, Doug James, coming around and spins and turns for a first down. But we talked about this Michigan team, how they attack you. They're going to pound the ball at you, set up some play-action fakes off the bounce play by Jim Harbaugh a little later on in the game.
White is just excellent tackle to tackle. Doesn't have the great breakaway speed. Kurkowski's come in defensively. Three linebackers. The pitch to White, and he's not going to get the corner. Excellent reaction by Jim Rogers, the strong safety. Let's check now the defense for these Washington Huskies. Reggie Rogers, Don Rogers' brother, the All-American now in the National Football League. Ron Holmes, All-American candidate. Alford, they like him. They think he's coming on very strong, just a sophomore. And Tony Lewis had an outstanding game last week. Fred Small had an interception against Northwestern. Two teams with good defenses still waiting for their offense to arrive. Triando Marcray split out on this play, along with Vince Bean. Second down, 11. Bob Perryman, and Perryman across the 35 to the 36. Tim Neamber made the stop. And let's look at the rest of that Washington defense. They've always been known to have active linebackers, and this guy was the Pac-10 Defensive Player of the Week for his play. Joe Kelly's their fastest linebacker. Besty Jackson had 4 interceptions last year. And J.C. Pearson, a junior college transfer. Jim Rogers, he goes after people. He'll hit you. And Tim Peoples, they think he will be in the same realm as a Ken Easley someday. Third and 6 now for Michigan. From the 36-yard line, Harbaugh. He was hit hard as he released the ball intended for Sim Nelson. Jim Rogers, the man we just talked about, was the guy who hit Harbaugh.
Yeah, well, you're going to see Harbaugh take some punishment right off the corner. Number 36, Joe Kelly, comes off the corner. He is not picked up. It was a mix-up in the offensive line protection. And that's what they wanted to do early to these young quarterbacks. Remember, we're talking about 2 inexperienced quarterbacks. Put some pressure on them early, see if he can shake them up, cause them to overthrow receivers or not play as well as they're capable of.
That's Danny Green back to receive this punt. Audie Robbins out of Great Bend, Kansas, hit it. He almost had it blocked. He gets an effective roll. I mean effective. If they can kill it, they can't get to it. And so the ball will be marked at the 20-yard line, and that kick will be recorded as a 64-yarder. Amadi Robbins had an excellent afternoon putting last game, and today has a 64-yarder. That is short of the record, however. Record is 76 yards, and Crazy Legs Hirsch, Elroy Hirsch, has that record in Michigan Stadium. There's a wave that they have instituted here, 105,000 people. On the 20-yard line, a handoff to Hunt. And by sheer determination, he gets a couple of yards.
We didn't get a chance to see all of the Michigan starters defensively. Let's look at them now. There's Tim Anderson. He's a walk-on from here in Ann Arbor. Very active. Mike Mallory, their leading tackler from a year ago. Garland Rivers, just a sophomore, but they predict greatness for him. Brad Cochran, a preseason All-American. And Doug Mallory, the brother of Mike. Their daddy, the coach at Indiana. And Tony Gant, they think that he's playing the best football of his career. Second down and nine. A little delay handoff to Jackson. Nothing. Kevin Brooks on the stop.
On both series that Washington has had thus far in the first quarter, they've come up in third and long situations. In their first series, they were third and six, and Danny Green dropped the ball. Now we're finding them at third and nine, third and ten. We have to remember, these are primarily running football teams. This is not the kind of situation they're best in. They want to be third and two, third and three type of situations, and this is not their environment.
It's not anybody's environment coming into Michigan Stadium, right?
You're right.
Third down, 10. That's Green in motion. Hugh Miller, all 6'4", 4.5, and on target that time. Mark Patterson made the stop. Did he get the first down? He did. Just across the front of that chain, Brad Cochran defending on the play, and that has to give him some confidence.
Well, and that's just what he needs early on in a hostile home environment. Hugh Millen gets to the corner. This is an unbalanced line with some motion. He sprints out, tries to break containment, and drills the ball, really the only place it can possibly be, right to the outside of Patterson. Nice footwork by Patterson. In college football, 1 foot you're in, 2 feet you're in, and first down.
Patterson and Millen were high school teammates in Seattle, and Patterson was the quarterback. Millen couldn't beat him out. Of course, now the roles have reversed. From the 30, first down, Jackson cuts it back nicely to the 34-yard line. Kevin Brooks on the stop.
Now, we talked at the top of the show, Gary, about Michigan's base play being the bounce play. And that, what you just saw there, is Washington's base play. Just a little pitch play to the outside. The key blocks there, the tight end and the fullback, as is Michigan's. The tailback reads those blocks, tries to get to the outside, but can option run virtually anywhere.
We're looking at Mike Mallory. As we mentioned, his dad now the coach in Indiana, and they're going to play in Bloomington on September 29th.
That'll be interesting for Mom.
I wonder who she'll root for. Boy, that shows you how big this stadium is, doesn't it? Background, second down. And in trouble is Millen. He got rid of it to Hunt. And Hunt has a first down. And that was an impressive play by Hugh Millen. Showed how strong he is. First down catch across the 40.
Hugh Millen is off to a very good start, as he really was last week. He avoids the rush. Now, he's a big man, but he was strong enough to be able to fight off the tackler and deliver the ball to Hunt before close to a first down. But this is one of the things that we were concerned about. Hugh Millen being able to get off to a quick start. The pressure that both of these defenses are going to put on quarterbacks. And you see, he took quite a hit there.
Yeah, it was Doug Mallory. He wanted to lay off, and they did not call it, but it is a first down. Again, Hugh Millen, he's so strong with that arm. If he has one problem, he throws too hard. But that time, good touch.
And you're right. And the concern they had was him getting off quickly, because he feels some of the pressure behind him, Hugh Millen does. He has two very good quarterbacks behind him, in Sicaro and Chandler. He knows he has to play well early.
He ran the scout squad last year and impressed Don James so much that they took a look at him in the spring, and he's their man. On a first down, Jackson advancing to the 43-yard line. Jim Scarcelli and Tim Anderson made the stop. The one thing about this Washington offense, they've always had the ability to pound it out, but they've had to replace a lot of people up front, as has Michigan.
Well, Washington only has two returning offensive linemen. Those are probably the most difficult men to replace. You have to be intelligent, and yet you still have to be aggressive. There's a lot of assignments those offensive linemen have to learn, so it's a difficult job in rebuilding your offensive line.
This guy replacing Steve Pullure, who was the Pac-10 Offensive Player of the Year, and he, in that fourth quarter last year, completed 14 straight to beat Michigan. Here is Jackson, running doggedly across the 45 to the 47. Mike Mallory again on the stop. Michigan's defense never been known, Pat, to be big, but they are active, and that's what they look for.
Well, that's their philosophy. Gary Moeller, their defensive coordinator, says they want to give each of their defensive players three separate options. They want to slant, they want to be aggressive, they want to jump around, and confuse you defensively. They are quick, and they get a lot of guys around the football. Watch that this afternoon.
Bo Schembechler, what stability he has given this Michigan program in 16 years. Third and three. McMillan, wide open is Hunt. Hunt has the first down to the 45-yard line. Cochran on the stop. And that's two times now Millen has gone to the fullback, something you might not expect.
One of the interesting things we want to watch about you, Millen, and I just happened to notice in last week's game, it was his first game, was when he comes up to the line of scrimmage and looks downfield at the defensive secondary, he threw the ball every time last week. When he comes up and puts his eyes down in the back of his offensive center, it's been a run. So that time he looked downfield and he did throw the ball. Let's watch that a little bit further.
Well, he's completed three in a row now. To the 45, first down, Michigan into the field. Millen to Jackson. And Jackson gets a yard and that's all. Good reaction by Brooks. Kevin Brooks is out of Detroit. And if there's one thing that he has to overcome is playing every down. He has great athletic ability. The pros are very excited about him. But Bo Schembechler, who is a man of perfection, will not condone or allow a guy not to play every down.
Well, you have to want to play every down in his defense, too. Can you imagine Gary Moeller not wanting to play for him?
Well, Bo will get after you a little bit if you get in his dugout. Look out.
Drives are downfield.
Pick up on that. Here is Millen. He's got it to Danny Green, and Green to the 42. What was that? You picked up something on Millen.
Well, it was just like I mentioned a little bit before. In last week's game, when you, Millen, looks downfield, as we saw there, looks downfield at the defensive coverage. You can see him. His head is up. His eyes are pointed downfield looking at the coverage. He has thrown the ball virtually every time last week. And when his eyes are down, they've run the football.
You got to go into coaching. Pick up those things. Third down and 7. 5.5 minutes left in the first quarter. No score from Michigan Stadium. Millen with protection on target. That one was caught by Rod Jones.
Oh, did a bad job of not getting the first down there.
He is just short of it, about a half yard. Michigan Stadium, the largest college-owned structure in the country. This is the 55th straight time they've had a crowd in excess of 100,000. And we're just very excited to be back this 1984 college football season. Millen, if that pass is now 5 of 6. It's going to be fourth down and less than a yard. Kenny has come in at fullback. Millen to sneak it. And that is where you have a big quarterback and it comes to an advantage. He weighs about 215 pounds, and he has the first down across the 35.
He's a big fellow, but he went right behind Dan Earnessy, his offensive center. Now, here's the key to the block. When you just need a couple of inches, watch the block, and the offensive right guard, Doug Crow, just cleared the way. He only needed a couple of inches. The center, Earnessy, and Crow cleared the way for Millen to pick up the first down.
Let me ask you something. Earnessy added an extra E to the end of his name so they could pronounce it.
How'd you like
I don't
to
understand that. How does that help?
How would you like to get his name in a spelling bee?
We just get it pronounced right. We're doing well.
I don't know how that makes it any easier to say. But
there's the extra E, Pat, for your benefit. First down. Complete to Finney and the sophomore fullback to the 22-yard line. That's a 13-yard gain.
This was a nice changeup by Washington because this is their sixth first down. All the first five were runs. This is their first down pass, but they've been short control passes, allowing Millen to get his rhythm, to feel confident in a hostile environment. We've seen him throw the ball to a couple of backs, Hunt, and now his other fullback, Rick Finney. Good game plan by Don James's Huskies.
We have a score. We understand that Alabama is losing after losing to Boston College in their first game. They trail 3-0. This is a 13th play on this drive. First down at the 22, Jackson. And he may have gotten a yard as Brad Cochran, coming up from the cornerback spot, made the stop along with Jim Scarcelli. Cookie Jackson, he said this week he was nicknamed Cookie because when his mother couldn't make him behave, the only way she could get him to do it was give him a cookie.
Does I have to give my kids $5 bills, you know?
They're well behaved, though, because I know your wife has some discipline. There's the score, Georgia Tech. Bill Curry's team, he's predicting some big things for the Ramblin' Wreck. Second down, 8. Jackson again to the 15, to the 10, he's to the 7. That'll be first and goal for the Huskies. Tony Gant, Mike Mallory over to make the tackle. And Jackson and Robinson give them great depth of tailback.
But the key block was by the tackle, Kevin Gogan, that you can see him right there on the right of the screen, 72. He just kicks Hammerstein out and allows Cookie Jackson to pick his way through a big hole. The key, of course, the big block by Gogan.
There is Jackson, Ron Cookie Jackson, a senior out of Franklin High School in Seattle. First and goal, the ball at the 8-yard line. Hunt is back in at fullback. Danny Green in motion. Jackson to the 5 and hit hard. That's Mallory, 42 over there, along with Cochran. Quite a collision. Jackson picking up 3 yards, and Danny Green getting up slowly. He's lost his helmet.
We'll play a little defensive back for the Wolverines and watch the intensity and the hitting down here by the goal line. This is for 6 points down here. Cookie Jackson running their base play, the sweep. But there's a whole host of Wolverines. We told you, they're aggressive defense. They got a lot of people around the football. As you see Danny Green getting injured walking off the field.
I think they were too aggressive, Pat. We have a penalty against Michigan.
Well, that can hurt.
There's Bo and Gary Moeller, his defensive coordinator.
The penalty's against the Huskies.
No, it's against the Huskies.
Holding on the offense. Down repeated.
Okay, so that'll bring it out to the 18-yard line. Gary Moeller, by the way, has a son playing on this Michigan team. We'll watch for him. He's number 49. 7 sets of brothers. He got all kinds of coaching connections.
Three
legacies here. Look at that. Michigan. That goes back, of course, to the Sugar Bowl when they held Auburn to 3 field goals.
And Bo Jackson.
First and 18. Beautiful catch. Patterson on the catch. Defending on the play was Garland Rivers. That shows you Patterson's ability to get up, how athletic he can be.
But the penalty really changed the complexion of this whole drive. During this whole drive, we saw Washington come down the field, run the power football, throw some short passes. Then they get backed up with the penalty with first and goal from the 17 or 18, and it's a whole different ball game. You have to throw the ball downfield.
What it did, it advanced them to the 14, where they still have second down. They had a first and goal, remember, at the 8 before all this began. Jackson in the backfield.
Looks like pass, his eyes are downfield. How did I know?
Jackson may have gotten a yard. He must have heard you. Somebody transmitted that information down. Dave Meredith, number 96, and Jim Starcelli again made the stop. So now it's going to be third down and still 14 to go.
Here's a situation last week where Don James called 2 or 3 draw plays early in the football game. You don't want to risk an interception. He called draws to put his field goal kicker, who's very good, Jeff Jaeger, in position to put 3 points on the board.
Jaeger had 4 field goals out of 5 attempts last week. Hunt, Jackson in the backfield. 2 minutes left in this first quarter. Millen fakes the draw. It's Roten, the tight end. Check that. Rod Jones, the tight end, and he's to the 7, and it's fourth down.
It looks like Jones is injured there as well.
Well, he's had a history of injury. Let's hope that's nothing serious.
Once again, Hugh Millen puts the ball on money, but he saw his eyes looking downfield at the secondary again. He has to get the ball into the end zone for the touchdown. He's just hoping that he get the ball to Rod Jones, and perhaps he can break a couple of tackles and get in the end zone, but certainly he did not, and they'll attempt the field goal here now on fourth down.
Jaeger last week's longest was 36. This will be a 25-yard attempt. 4 of 5 last week against Northwestern. A sophomore, a little chip shot for him, and he's down the middle with that one. So Jeff Jaeger out of Kent, Washington, last year, outstanding job for these Huskies, and now he's hit 5 of his first 6 in 1984. The Boshin Beckler and Michigan through the years have been tough here, but if you want to come in and get things started in the right way, you've done it the way Washington's done it. 9 minutes and 3 seconds on that drive, covering 73 yards.
They really just stopped themselves with a penalty, otherwise it might have been a touchdown.
Jaeger to kick off. Back deep is Jamie Morris, a freshman, to let it hit. And Morris struggles out to the 10-yard line. The ball is loose, but it's been blown dead. All right, let's go back to New York and join our host, Pat O'Brien, for this college football report.
Thank you, Gary. In addition to Washington versus Michigan, there are many other important games today, including Penn State at Iowa and Notre Dame at Michigan State. Coach Eric Parsegan and I will be keeping you up to date with scores and highlights at halftime and throughout the afternoon on our college football report. We'll see you later. Let's now go back to Gary and Pat. Gary.
Pat, thank you. And Eric, we'll look forward to that. Here's our score, 3-0. Not a good start now on that kickoff. Michigan at their own 10-yard line. Harbaugh. Ryan Holmes makes the stop on Bob Perryman. Tomorrow, an NFL doubleheader on CBS Sports featuring an NFC battle between the Chicago Bears, they're 2-0, and the Green Bay Packers. Then in the doubleheader game, many of you will see the Eagles take on the Cowboys. Be sure now to check the local listings. I think Mike Ditka has those Bears rolling.
Their defense is playing very, very well.
Yes, they are. Three linebackers now in defensively for Washington. Second down and 8. Rodgers, you see, 39, taking the blitz. Harbaugh. Sim Nelson, the tight end, and hit immediately by Jim Rodgers.
A lot of work there for not much of a gain, really.
Rodgers has an interesting story. He's twice broken his arm. One time he was minding his own business in the bar, and some guy started a fight and almost poked his eye out. He had a key in his hand when he punched it.
He flies around the football field. He's the kind of guy that John Madden would love. He's flying all over the place, making tackles.
You want him on your side.
That's right.
There's your time left in the first quarter. 3rd and 5 for the Wolverines. First down catch by Vince Bean. Here's a man that the scouts tell me is a real sleeper in the draft. Vince Bean, the senior out of Southfield, Michigan.
Well, Vince Bean is one of those fluid type of athletes. Now, did you ever think you'd see Bo Schembechler in the first quarterback throw the football? He's got a different philosophy. He is throwing the football. He's got a man who can do it in Harbaugh. He drilled the ball right to Vince Bean. The only place he could get it, Bean ran the disciplined route to pick up the first down.
And that's the name of his game, is disciplined routes. He runs them to perfection. First down at the 27, and that gets Michigan out of that big hole. Harbaugh with some operating room. Gerald White. White moves the pile forward across the 30 to the 31. Tony Lewis made the stop. Don James mirrors Bo Schembechler, and probably for good reason. They both started in Ohio, Midwestern background, same type offenses. And we have played our first quarter here in Michigan Stadium. 3-0. The Huskies with the lead, and this is the 8th meeting between the two. College football, Michigan Stadium, just a beautiful afternoon in Ann Arbor. Michigan starting the second quarter, the 2nd and 6. And bursting out of there was Gerald White. 9-yard pickup. Peoples and Ron Holmes made the stop. And as you look at the first 15 minutes, Washington, look at their time of possession.
Well, that is the key statistic there. Normally, when you think of a Michigan football team, you think of them controlling the football. But Washington had a very impressive drive there in the first down in the first quarter, which got them the 3 points.
They still didn't give up that touchdown, did they? They made him settle for the field goal. They're keeping now 10 quarters without a touchdown scored rushing. From the 40, first down for Harbaugh. Bob Perryman out of Buzzards Bay, Massachusetts. You got to be tough if you come from Buzzards Bay, right?
We should give a Most Valuable City award this year. It's up there among them.
Well, he was an MVP last week, scoring 3 touchdowns. You can see 89 yards.
And he rushed the ball 17 times. This is something new, again, in Bo Schembechler's offense, his fullback carrying the football more.
Line of scrimmage just across the 43. It'll be 2nd down 7. Wolverines. Johnson split to the near side. Vince Bean to the top. Gerald White. And White, the sophomore out of Titusville, Florida. Jim Krakowski, Tim Meamber made the stop. White is an excellent runner, tackle to tackle. But also what they like about him, he catches the ball so well.
And he cuts in. Watch number 51, Reggie Rogers, though, of Washington. Here's a man who's a basketball player. It's his first year of football since high school. And last week, he had to play against a passing team and drop off in coverage and play soft. This week, Bo Schembechler wanted to run right at him and see if he can handle the run, too. It has to be much more physical, a different type of game plan for 51 Reggie Rogers.
He's 6'7", weighs 235. Diving, trying to pick up the first down. Going to be very close. All right, let's check a couple of other scores on this college afternoon. West Virginia, Don Nealon and his team leading Virginia Tech 7-0. That was a first down, by the way, for the Michigan Wolverines. And North Carolina leading the Middies of Navy. Going to have a tough time holding down Napoleon McCallum, the outstanding running back. Line of scrimmage now at the 49 of Washington. 13:11 to go in the first half.
Let's go,
at halftime, we'll be joining Pat O'Brien and Eric Parsegian. And our feature of Echoes of the Past with Lindsey Nelson. I think you're going to like that. White, Perryman in the backfield. Here's White. And also here is Steve Albert, number 93.
Interesting contrast there, as you saw Jim Harbaugh's eyes there, too. You saw him actually looking downfield at the coverage, and yet he still did run the football.
Albert is a sophomore, as you look now at 73, Doug James. James out of Louisville. He's upset. That offensive line, Pat, is a concern. They've lost Tom Dixon, Stephon Humphreys, DeOrio, another guard. They seem to mass produce them, but they're still not where they want to be. It's not playing like a Michigan line.
Well, they didn't give Harbaugh much protection last week, and running Bo Schembechler's offense, it's all got to start up there at the Great Wall.
Second down, 11 for the Wolverines. Harbaugh being chased, gets away from Reggie Rogers. A nifty run to the 45, to the 40. An 11-yard scamper. 10 people eventually came up to drop him. And Harbaugh shows that he can ad-lib a little bit.
He gives you his Doug Flutie imitation. Well, this is the thing. Sometimes you don't expect this of a man who is 6'3 and 200 pounds, but Jim Harbaugh can run the ball very, very well. He's looking downfield. The protection, again, this is the concern that Bo had about his protection. Too many people in Harbaugh's face, but then he turns a negative play into a positive play. He's going to duck a little right. He gets, did, right underneath Tim Peoples.
You know, number 79 on that play, Doug Miller, or Clay Miller, actually threw a block with his helmet. Did you see that coming off across the field?
Speaking of fights, we've got a good one coming up this week here.
Hitman Hearns.
Oh, yeah. The Detroit hitman, didn't he?
Yep. Against Hutchins.
Weren't you the Wichita State non-hitman? The no-hitman?
Slew of gold and from Belmont, Woodward and Futurity Stakes. That'll be very interesting, too. So we've got a lot coming your way. What kind of a helmet is that?
A decorated one.
Well, it's going to be third down. He just missed the first down, all that running. He picked up almost 11 yards. Gerald White, and White has it. Ball is fumbled, and Washington has recovered. Jim Rogers comes up with it. From Aloha, Oregon, he is the spiritual leader defensively for this Husky team. And from the 35, Washington will take over at the 11:43 mark.
Is Thomas Hearns the most devastating puncher in boxing today? Find out when he defends his WBC world title live on CBS Sports Saturday. Next.
Well, on this replay, Pat will reconstruct what happened.
Tim Niambra, the linebacker, is right there in the middle of the screen for Huskies. He gets his right elbow right in on the ball right there. The ball pops loose on Gerald White. That's the big turnover. Now, Niambra, now watch again. He's there in the middle of the screen. His right elbow is going to come up and strip the ball out of Gerald White's arms. White is diving for the first down. Niambra is always around the football. Last week, he had three interceptions. He recovered a fumble last week as well, and then he caused one right here.
They feel he's as good as they've had, and they've had some outstanding linebackers. So at the 35, the drive stalls. Washington at the 11:43 mark with a 3-0 lead in the second quarter. Ron Cookie Jackson gets close to the 40-yard line. Mike Mallory made the stop once again. We have not seen Jock Robinson, the other tailback from Rose Bowl fame, who was the MVP as a freshman, but that shows you again, as effective as Jackson is, they got another guy equal.
And Rick Rogers in Michigan, the same situation there as well. Had 1,000 yards last year.
But he's in that doghouse I was talking about earlier.
There's the first down play selection. It's been a little bit more balanced on Washington's behalf.
Rick Finney. Finney has what they call NFL statistics as far as size. He's 6'3", 235, a very heralded recruit. He, along with Chris Chandler of a year ago, the quarterback who's number three now, they thought two of the best players to come out of the state in a long time.
Very good receiver as well, and they've been throwing the football a lot to their fullbacks.
Called him the strongest running back they've ever had. Third down, 2 yards. Hillen's going to tuck it and run, and he's going to be short of the first down. Jim Scarcelli and Joe Gray. Now, Pat, do you think he honestly looked deep long enough, or did he just take off and go?
That looked like a designed run to me. Looked like you milling a sticky run, and it's not a bad call on a third and two situation. Really, the most pressure you can put on the defense is having a quarterback who can get out to the corner and have the option of running or throwing the football.
West Virginia's added to their advantage, and Navy's now scored. Army-Navy will be coming your way on CBS December 1st. Gant, number 14, will go back. Thane Cleveland will kick. End over end. Gant for the 15. Finds an opening. And Tony Gant to the 28-yard line. Cochran made the stop. 41-yard kick. And an excellent 14-yard return. Washington 3-0 on the strength of a 25-yard field goal by Jeff Jaeger. And this is the best field position now that Michigan has had to start a drive from the 28-yard line.
Washington has always been known for special teams backing people up, although their special teams did not play well last week against Northwestern. That is a characteristic of Don James' teams.
In fact, did Michigan go out and study that?
Precisely right.
They went out to Seattle, see how they did it. Here comes Gerald White. He's got two blocks, and he's to the 30-yard line. CBS Sports is proud to announce our continued association with the Chevrolet Scholarship Program. As we did last season, Pat and I will be selecting a Chevrolet MVP from each team as part of every 84 CBS Sports College Football telecast. And Chevrolet will then honor those selections by donating $1,000 to each college's general scholarship fund to help advance the educations of deserving students in their chosen fields. And this is the 14th year we've had the Chevrolet Scholarship Program. From the 30. Second and eight.
Well done, Gary.
I'm going to have you read that next week, all right? But we are glad to have him with us. Here's Harbaugh, again, doing a good job scrambling. He has a first down. And he's hit out of bounds by Rogers. That'll be unsportsmanlike conduct. Rogers is a wild man, but that time he lost his vision as to where the field ended.
Another look at the late hit on Jim Harbaugh. Now he's running for his life. Another impromptu play. You just cannot defend against this. He clearly steps out of bounds right there. And here comes the late hit by Jim Rogers. Good call by the official.
That'll be 15 yards. Interestingly enough, Pat, Michigan has gone away from the option. They didn't think Harbaugh could run that well.
Both told us that yesterday.
Personal foul, the defense. First down.
Well, he's been spoiled a little bit because he had Steve Smith, who was so fast.
Jim Rogers, he is an aggressive safety, and really you want that out of your strong safety, but you have to temper that. When a guy's out of bounds, you have to lay off.
There's a time for a little bit of just having good common sense. And here is White to the 35-yard line.
That is Michigan's seventh first down play, and they've yet to throw the ball on first down. Now, we talked to some people last year about Michigan, and that was one of the characteristics. They did not throw the ball on first down. Defenses knew that. So far today, they have not done that.
Well, you know, we had a conversation with Don James, and he is not convinced that Michigan was going to throw that much. He says, I keep reading they're going to throw more and more, and he just had to be shown here today that that's actually going to happen. Jamie Morris now in the backfield. The 5'7" freshman is the tailback. And here he goes. This is a brother of Joe Morris of the Giants, formerly of Syracuse. Tim Neamber made the stop. And Bo Schembechler cannot say enough about 23. He calls him cute. He's 5'7", has the long arms. But he's one of the few freshmen to ever play in the first game at a running back spot.
Did you ever think Bo would call a player cute? Michigan's play selection, however, he is kind of cute.
Look at him. Yeah, what do you mean?
Michigan's play selection, really, though, on first and second down has been this pounding the football, grinding the football out. Then they're going to have to loosen up here and throw the football downfield on first down.
Third down and six for the Wolverines. All kinds of time. Excellent job by Joe Kelly. Oh, is he upset? He's their fastest linebacker. He led them in tackles last week, which, by the way, was the most of any player in the Pac-10. He's going to hurt himself flopping around like that.
Well, you're right. Jim Harbaugh has excellent protection. Remember, this was the concern that Bo had last week. Not very good protection. But Joe Kelly read his eyes the whole way. Now, Harbaugh looked at his receiver the whole time and allowed Joe Kelly, the defensive linebacker, to follow his eyes. A little frustration in college football by Joe Kelly.
Looked like breakdancing to me. That was going to be now a 52-yard attempt by Bob Bergeron. The longest he kicked was 51 last year. This would be a record for him. It's good. Tied at 51, Landry Bergeron and Bob Wood, and now we have a new one.
Ho-hum, just another 52-yarder.
You know, he's been trying to gain weight, eats pizza all the time. He just can't gain any weight. But
you have that same problem.
Well, that's right. I'm glad you noticed. Now, kicking off will be Slopey. They have real specialists here. They got Bergeron, who kicks the field goals, and Slopey, who kicks off. Slopey started last year as a field goal kicker and then lost the job to Bergeron. Denzel Hill and Danny Green back for Washington. It's all tied up in three. Hill. And he's out to the 23-yard line. We have just been told by our CBS management that we will be in the Rose Bowl. UCLA and Nebraska, the Cornhuskers, a number one ranked team in the country. And some of you will see Iowa against Ohio State, and you talk about two excellent games on week number two on CBS. We're just glad to be part of it. Glad to have you with us.
A lot of offense next week.
Ooh. Jock Robinson in the backfield now as he's replaced Jackson, a tailback. Here he goes, Jock Robinson. He's to the 26-yard line. Jock Robinson last year had weight problems. He came in about 15 pounds overweight. He's never really had the kind of career forecast for him. But make no mistake about it, he has ability.
You know, he had that big freshman year. He had 900 yards as a sophomore. But what Don James is concerned about is him getting his shoulders turned square to the line of scrimmage and running upfield. It seems like he's trying to break everything for a touchdown.
Dana 3, second and 7. Millen. Target to Hunt. Hunt has the first down, and that has been their big play, throwing to the fullback.
This is the adjustment that the Michigan defense is going to have to find the answer to, is finding a way to cover the fullback out of the backfield of Washington. That's the fourth time they've completed that pass. It's a very safe and easy throw. It keeps drives alive, keeps the chains moving, and a good call by Don James.
On the 35, first down. Patterson and Green will be split to the top of your screen. Nine passes in a row now have been completed by Hugh Millen. He's 9 of 10 for the game.
Had the other one dropped.
Right. That was Green in motion. Jock Robinson slithers across the 35 to the 37. Michigan defense has had to play a lot in this first half. You don't figure a team very often to come into Michigan Stadium and play with poise. It's intimidating. For instance, when Bo beat Miami last week, he is now 15-0-1 in home openers here.
With the type of offense that Washington's played, the slow, methodical, grind it out type of offense really takes that home field advantage away from the team.
Andy Moeller now has come in at linebacker, the defensive coordinator's son. Wald Hunt. And Hunt to the 42-yard line. He'll be a couple of yards short of the first down. Joe Gray, 92, made the stop. And mentioning Gray, I watched Al Cincich, their all Big Ten nose guard yesterday. He was in such pain. They wanted to play him. He had one of those electric stimulators on his back trying to get it ready. He's had back trouble all the time. So Gray, 92, has had to fill in for him. Cincich was really upset. He wanted to play so bad today.
Let's see if they run their fullback into the flat here again on third and three.
In motion goes Hunt. Protection is there. The pass a little behind Patterson. Defending was Garland Rivers. Rivers, who will hit you? They think he's going to have a great future out of Canton, Ohio, the home of the Hall of Fame. And that's going to bring up fourth down.
Really, it was the first bad throw we've seen by Millen here this afternoon, but I'm surprised. They've been so successful throwing the fullback into the flat. Really, you should probably do that until they take it away. Force them to take that play away from you before you go to something else.
Gant goes back. He had that 14-yard return. You see what Cleveland's facing. Gant from the 17. He's got a seam. 25. Tripped up. If you wonder why Gant runs so well, he in high school was the Ohio High School Back of the Year. 12-yard return, a 41-yard punt. I guess congratulations should be in order to Don James of Washington, voted the coach, the number one coach in the country by Sports Illustrated.
It was interesting. I asked him yesterday who he thought the best coach in the country was. He kind of laughed and said, right across the sideline, Bo Schembechler.
Well, he was right up there. Washington's had the ball 15 minutes of this game. Michigan less than 10. They have it first down from the 29. Here's White, and this time, excellent reaction, and that's Reggie Rogers. A man who's played basketball, his brother Don, talked him into going out for football. The outstanding safety for UCLA.
Well, this was the question mark that Don James had. Could he handle a physical type of team like Michigan? You saw him kind of weed his way through two or three players, give him a shoulder here, give him a shoulder there, then boom, he's right there for the tackle on Gerald White. So far, he has answered Don James' question about him.
Skip Hall, their assistant head coach, said the first day he came out for practice, we knew he was a player.
He's an athlete.
Second down, 12. Ball, and that ball he just threw away. Nobody open. It'll bring up third down. Pat, one thing I'd like to develop a little bit. We talked about Don James and Bo Schembechler, two outstanding coaches, solid programs, great stability, and a lot of what's been in the newspapers lately about cheating and the problems and the probation. It's kind of refreshing, isn't it?
Well, it really shows you that two coaches can run programs and still be successful without resorting to those things. Bo said some interesting things. He thinks the cheaters are the ones who have to be most concerned, and it's such a distraction because you're always trying to cover something up.
Well, he said it's tougher to recruit today than it's ever been. Third down, 12. Intercepted, Joe Kelly. The ball at the 25-yard line, and Joe Kelly has put Washington in excellent position. Out of Los Angeles Jefferson High School. Fastest linebacker, and you saw how he took off with the ball.
Well, we saw a little earlier his disappointment when he dropped an interception. This time, watch Harbaugh. The Harbaugh is following his receiver the whole way. It really is a poor selection, and Joe Kelly is right there. The ball was thrown right to him. This time, he holds on to it, secures the football. It actually fumbled.
Yes,
ball
it is.
Ball down on the ground. It looked like Ron Holmes, number 90, picked it up, but Joe Kelly picks off the Jim Harbaugh's pass.
On the 25, that's the third interception Harbaugh's thrown this season. He had two last week. Three all our score. Jock Robinson inside the 20-yard line. Nate Rogers now playing nose guard, and if there's any man that will not condone the turnover, it's that guy, Bo Schembechler. You know, last week against Miami, he was just absolutely unbelievable. They had six interceptions at Kozar. And
two fumble recoveries.
Yeah. So it's reversed a little bit here.
Yeah, remember, Washington forced 7 turnovers last week as well.
Second down, 4 for the Huskies. Millen to Robinson. And Robinson, diving forward, may have gotten the first down. Brad Cochran made contact, but he slid forward, and that may be enough. Robinson out of San Jose, California. He led the Pac-10 in rushing as a sophomore. Last year, while he averaged over 6 yards a carry, was under 300 yards for the year, and that's just too much talent for number 28 to have that kind of year. First down at the 14.
Last drive down here, they had a penalty.
Remember now, Michigan in 10 quarters hasn't given up a touchdown rushing. Robinson again. They're moving that line forward.
Good line blocking and interesting play selection by Don James. It's really been the first counter play we've seen by Washington. Washington has come out and pounded the ball off tackle with their tailbacks. They've run some plays where they sprinted Umillen out and he's dropped back and passed. But that time was the first counter action that you've seen, trying to move Michigan's linebackers, getting them out of position.
There's your time left in this first half. Green, Hill splits to the top of the screen. Second down, 7. Robinson inside the 10 to about the 7. It's going to bring up a third down. That's Anderson, 57. At halftime, we saw this piece earlier, and I'm really excited about it. Lindsey Nelson talking about fielding Yost in the great Michigan team of 1901.
Well, it is a beautiful piece, but here you see Jack Robinson, and this is what Don James wants to see more of him. Him making tough 2-3-4-yard runs and not looking for the cutback lane all the time and getting his shoulders turned toward the defense where he can pick up yards.
Andy Moeller comes in, replacing Anderson at linebacker. Third down and 5. Green in motion. Millen to throw. Complete. And out of bounds goes Rod Jones. And he's short. It's going to be fourth down.
Well, that's the second time Rod Jones has done that today. And I know this is, he has not played tight end much. They're going to measure it. But it's the second time he has done this. Now, Rod Jones is 3rd and 3, remember. Now, on a situation like this, when you're driving for a touchdown, it's absolutely critical that the receiver know where the first down markers are and make sure you run the route accordingly. It looked like he stepped inside the first down marker.
That might be that inexperience. We said he's had freakish injuries, breaking a leg last year, and maybe he did get the first down, but it looked like initially he did not.
Well, we'll see what kind of call Don James is going to make, too.
Ooh, I think he got it, didn't he? Yes, he did.
Okay, I take it back, Rod.
Well, Rod, whatever
we Jones,
said.
I'm sorry.
Anybody back there in Richmond, California watching this game, we didn't mean it. But seriously, it was a good point because earlier he didn't spot that forward mark, and this time he did. Now Ron Jackson's going to come into the ball game.
In last week's game here, they ran toward the fullback, Walt Hunt, every time down against Northwestern, down inside the 5-yard line.
And Millen wants a timeout. Timeout, 1:45 to go in the first half. 3-all at Ann Arbor. On this play, Pat, you've studied this in the film room. We have 2 fullbacks in. What do you expect with Hunt and Finney in there?
Well, I just saw the one game against Northwestern last week, and Walt Hunt, they line him generally up at the wingback rather than the fullback position. They sent him in motion last week against Northwestern and ran to his side every time. In other words, they changed the strength of the formation but followed the block of Walt Hunt.
Well, you know, they call that sometimes a zoom tight end. I know Terry Donahue uses that terminology.
But Michigan's watched the film as well. They know that as well.
And see, he's lined up. You see him at the wing position at the top of the screen. We'll see if they run right. Well, they didn't do anything. How about that? Straight ahead football that time by Rick Finney. Well, they knew the coaches were watching the films too.
Well, this is, again, they've had 4 downs to get the ball into the end zone here, and it's critical. And here's with this offensive line, the concern that Don James has about this young offensive line of his is utmost, because this is the toughest part of the field for these guys to move 9-10 defensive players out, because everybody is closing in on the offensive play.
Second goal to 2. Robinson has come back in. Correction, Jackson in. Hunt now in motion. And they cross back to Finney. He is in for the touchdown. Touchdown. this crowd, this partisan Wolverine crowd, just sitting a little stunned right now. It's 9-3. Another impressive drive after that interception by Joe Kelly. Chris Chandler will hold on this placement by Jaeger. And Jaeger is able to add the point after 10-3.
Beautiful hole for Rick Finney, the big fullback of Washington. Those offensive line, we talked about them. You're going to see a big hole open up. It's down on the goal line. It's 3rd and 3. He just follows the block of his center, Dan Earnessy, into the end zone for 6 points.
Good job.
Walter Payton began this season needing 688 yards to become the all-time rushing leader. The chase is on.
The Bears and Packers among the games tomorrow on CBS Sports.
Washington with a 10-3 lead. We'll look again at that two-yard run by Rick Finney, the big 235-pound sophomore fullback.
Yeah, but the touchdown really was set up by the interception by Joe Kelly. It was only a 7-play drive, a very opportunistic defense and offense of Washington. Again, characteristic of both of these coaches. But in the drive, we saw Jock Robinson run off tackle a couple of times as you watch the time of possession. We saw the big catch by Rod Jones for the first down that kept the drive alive.
That was a look at Jamie Morris back deep for this kickoff as Jaeger will boot it off. Just interestingly enough, Michigan last year never trailed at halftime here at home. And last year they trailed Washington in Seattle 10-3 at halftime. Now North Carolina has bumped their lead up. The Crumbs Club. This kick may be out of the end zone. That means the ball will come out to the 30-yard line. The new rule this year is that if the kick sails out of the end zone, you start from the 30-yard line. And they've been concerned about Jaeger. He has had a trouble all preseason long trying to keep that ball from being kicked out.
It really does seem like kind of a silly rule, though. You're penalizing the kicker for performing well. There is some debate that Don James is not particularly happy with the rule.
By the way, that touchdown by Finney a while ago was the first time Michigan's given up a rushing touchdown in 10 quarters. They come in here in a tough place, and they're not intimidated at all. Harbaugh. That pass intended for Eddie Garrett, number 32, the fullback. Garrett did not play last week because of a knee injury.
That was their first down pass of the first half. We talked a little bit about that. It was supposed to be a screen pass, nice and safe. It didn't quite work out. The ball was deflected away.
It's hard sometimes, Pat, to get away from trends and traditions to throw on first down. You just haven't been doing it very many times here at Michigan. 2 of 7 for 15 yards. The interception is Harbaugh. He gives off to Morris. Morris comes out of there, and the freshman to the 44-yard line. 10 people's made the stop, a 14-yard run.
Has got some timeouts here, but here's Jamie Morris. He calls him his change of pace. They pound in there with Gerald White, their bigger tailback. Jamie Morris is a little guy. It's a little draw action. Washington was defending against the pass, and boom, Jamie Morris, a quick little back, comes in.
Michigan in a hurry-up situation, and Harbaugh is sacked. Fred Small, number 5, who is so tough to block. He's built low to the ground. He's 6 foot, weighs 230. The first sack of the game, and they lose it back to the 37-yard line. And there's your time left. Timeout now for Michigan.
This Michigan offense looks a little bit numb out there, to a surprise. I don't think they expected this Washington defense to be as aggressive as they are. And Don James is actually calling his entire defense over to him to talk to them.
Well, Harbaugh's best phase of his game has been scrambling. He's run very well, has not been very effective in the passing game. Both teams now have 2 timeouts remaining with 31 seconds left in this first half. Later today, live championship boxing. Thomas Hitman Hearns, his super welterweight title will go on the line against the WBC's third-ranked contender, Fred Hutchins. And you'll see Fit to Fight, the handicapped Triple Crown winner. Dual defending champion Slew Gold in the Woodward, live from New York's Belmont Park. That's all coming up more right here on CBS Sports Saturday.
You do that pretty well. Impressed.
Old farm boy. I used to ride a couple of horses, but not quite in the same caliber.
You're from Phoenix, that's right. You got a donkey back there, don't you?
From the 37 now, after that loss, it's 2nd and 16. Garrett would still be about 10 yards short of the first down. Tony Lewis made the stop.
And two
Brown
timeouts.
Not happy here that they're not throwing the football.
Two timeouts.
Jamie Morris comes in, and they're not using a timeout. They're going to have to hurry.
Well, their man just kicked a 52-yard field goal a little while ago, too. It surprises me.
6 seconds. Another give to Jamie Morris, and look at this little guy go. And that will end the first half. They're at the 41-yard line, and the crowd is not happy. 10-3, Washington leads. College football on CBS will continue after this commercial message and a word from your local station.
Hi, everybody. It is halftime, and welcome to our New York studios. I'm Pat O'Brien, and this is the College Football Report, where you not only get the scores and highlights, but also the expertise of the coach, Eric Parsegan. And I get to make the announcement, you're going back on the field. But not the coach, right?
No. Next week, I'll be with Brent Musburger at the Ohio State-Iowa game, looking forward to it, and every other week with you, Pat.
You know, this has been an interesting year so far. We've had three number one teams, Auburn, Miami, and now Nebraska. You pick Nebraska. You like them to stay all the way, don't you?
I do. I think the schedule favors them, and I think when you're number one early, it's great for fans, but what the coaches want to see is who's number one at the end of the season.
All right, Coach, let's get right to the scoreboard because we have an upset in the making. Out in Atlanta at Grant Field, Georgia Tech now leads Alabama in the second quarter, 13-0. And, Coach, the Yellow Jackets are looking to sting the Crimson Tide there.
Watch here as the Crimson Tide does do a good job on defense. They stop Keith Glanton, but Bobby Lovett on the next play on a pitch out from Newberry, the quarterback. Watch here, beautifully executed play. That's Bill Curry, the coach of Georgia Tech, very pleased with this result. And here's Bobby Lovett taking it in for a touchdown. I don't know whether Alabama's recovered from Doug Flutie of last Saturday night.
Georgia Tech, the last time they beat Alabama at Grant Field was 1962. 13-0 there. North Carolina now, 14 over Navy 3 in the second quarter. Eddie Colson has two touchdowns for North Carolina. Incidentally, North Carolina is a quick starting team, 23-2 in its first five games of the last five seasons. The Mountaineers are off to a good start, 14-0 over Virginia Tech in the first quarter. Missouri takes a 7-0 lead over Wisconsin in the first quarter. And, Coach, you like Warren Sipes.
Right, watch him hit the hot receiver right here, Tony Davis. And watch two Wisconsin players knock one another off right there. And Davis goes down the right sideline. Watch here as he fumbles as he goes into the end zone. Is he over? Did he cross the plane? The officials say yes, and it's a touchdown.
Good call, Coach. 7-0 there. Ohio and Ball State just underway in the first quarter. There's no score there. In East Lansing, Michigan State and Notre Dame just underway. No score there. Michigan State has not beat Notre Dame in East Lansing since 1968. There's your Maryland Vanderbilt score. 3-0 in the first quarter. East Carolina 7 over Central Michigan. Nothing. That's in the first quarter. And Connecticut leads Lehigh 7-0 in the first quarter. We'll have more in a discussion with the coach when College Football Report continues. Stay with us. One of the changes in college football this season is a modification in the penalty for pass interference. It's a change that's already stirred up controversy. Up until now, the ball would be spotted at the point of infraction. When a flag was thrown in the end zone, the ball was placed on the 1 yard line. But this season, pass interference brings a first down 15 yards from the line of scrimmage, no matter how far down the field the play took place. Now, Coach, this rule has already stirred up some controversy last weekend.
Exactly. In the San Diego State-UCLA game, we saw an example of it. Todd Santos, watch here, the San Diego quarterback, throws a pass intended for Vince Warren. Watch Ron Pitts, the UCLA defender, come in, make a legitimate effort to knock the ball down. Interference is called. Last year, the ball would have been placed on the 1 yard line. The new rule, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down. Two plays later, KC Brown of San Diego State, running the ball off tackle for a 5 yard gain, fumbles, UCLA recovers, and wins the ball game 18-15.
And San Diego State might have won that game. Doug Scoville, of course, hates the rule, at least last weekend, but you like it, don't you?
I do. I know it's a controversial rule. The coaches voted for it, but I don't think a touchdown should be earned. I don't think there should be a penalty any more than 15 yards and an automatic first down. That's what they got.
What about crucial games, coaches? Will coaches tell their players to pull them down in a crucial game?
I really don't think so. You saw a legitimate effort on the part of UCLA to knock the ball down. Interference is called. I think it'll work both ways during the course of the season.
All right. The coach likes the new rule change. Okay. Coming up later this afternoon, following the conclusion of our football game, CBS Sports Saturday returns with a full lineup of action. And for a rundown, here's Brent Musburger.
The Hitman is back. In June, Thomas Hearns destroyed Roberto Duran in the second round. Duran had gone the distance against marvelous Marvin Hagler. but he was no match against the 6'1" Hearns. This afternoon, Saginaw, Michigan, and you will see Hearns battle 6'2" Fred Hutchings. Hutchings has won his last 23 fights. It'll be Hearns and Hutchings, 12 rounds for the WBC Super Welterweight Championship. You'll also see a championship in horse racing. It is the top four-year-old in training, Slew of Gold in the Woodward Stakes, squaring off against Fit to Fight and Shifty Chic. This could be the best race since Affirmed in Alidar. And what do the Jacksons have to do with professional football? We'll tell you later today. With Welcome to the NFL, Michael Jackson. All coming up on CBS Sports Saturday after the football game.
And welcome back to College Football Report. A couple of updates on some scores when we come back. Please stay with us. We'll be here in a moment. Update you on a couple of scores now out in Columbia, Missouri. The Badgers have just scored. It is now 7-7 in the second quarter there. Michigan State now leads Notre Dame 12-0. They just scored a touchdown, and Carl Butler is doing some job for Michigan State.
Watch the missed tackles here. I don't want to take anything away, certainly, from Michigan State. But you can see there are the missed tackles. Outstanding running by Butler. Here again, Butler going to the left side. It's well blocked. He shakes another tackle here and goes into the end zone for the second score. A real shocker for the Irish.
And they are looking for an upset there. The game we're watching now, Washington leads Michigan 10-3. What do you see that you like so far?
Well, I think one of the things that Michigan has to be concerned about, because a year ago in the second half, Pelor completed 15 straight passes. Millen completed in one drive, 8-for-8. He has 10-for-12. And I would be concerned if I was Bo Schembechler stopping their pass attack. They stopped Kosar last week, can't stop Millen this week.
All right, Coach, thank you. Let's take you back out to Ann Arbor, Michigan, and Gary Bender and Pat Hayden. Gentlemen?
Pat, thank you very much. This is the same score we had at halftime last year in Seattle, 10-3. And in the background, you can see the band here, the University of Michigan Marching Band. And what a spectacle it is. What an outstanding moment of pageantry in college football. That's a takeoff, by the way, on Ghostbusters. 10-3, our halftime score, and each week at halftime, we have a special feature called The Echoes of College Football. One of the grand men who's been around college football so many years, Lindsey Nelson, is going to be our host. Let's go down to Knoxville, Tennessee, for this week's feature.
For a college football fan, it's possible to call up memories of a lifetime just for the mention of a date or a place or a name. A name that cast its magic spell on the college scene, moved on, and left impressions that endure forever. Names such as Fielding Yost. He was a great coach at Michigan early in the century. At that time, college football was king, and its princes had names like Newt Rockne, Bob Zupke, Pop Warner, Amos Alonzo Stagg, and Fielding Hurry Up Yost. What kind of a person was Fielding Yost? Well, there was little argument that he was an exhibitionist and full of ego. He was loud, talkative, a braggart, but what a football player. Unlike many others of his time and since, Yost placed little importance on fundamentals. His aim was the big, spectacular play. He coached for 25 years at the University of Michigan, and he had 13 unbeaten teams. His team in 1901 scored 550 points and shut out the opposition. And then they went to the first Rose Bowl and shut out Stanford 49-0. There have been many coaches who followed, of course, and each has left his mark. Men like Bernie Bierman, Fritz Kreisler, Ray Elliott, Woody Hayes, Bo Schembechler, Era Parsigian. But it was Fielding Yost and his contemporaries who set the standards and molded the undying football tradition. This is Lindsey Nelson with some of the echoes of college football.
10-3, Washington leads the Michigan Wolverines here in Michigan Stadium. Pat, at the start of this telecast, you said one thing. Hugh Millen of Washington has to take on a bigger role.
And that's precisely what he did in the first half. Remember last week, he really didn't throw the ball very well. This week he has. He's 10 of 12 for 71 yards. He's kept drives alive. He's thrown the ball really short, controlled type of passes, Gary.
Well, interestingly enough, four of those have gone to his fullbacks.
And Michigan's going to have to find a way to adjust that. They have to take that fullback away by putting another linebacker on him or not letting him out of the backfield.
Time of possession, it's a startling stat.
It really is. When you consider Bo Schembechler's teams, you look there, Washington's had it 6 more minutes than Michigan now, and they've been times where they've gone down and done something with the ball. They had the turnover, and we saw, here's Rick Finney. You can see him going to the end zone at the end of one of those long drives, but they've been opportunistic. They've held the ball. They've controlled the football. It's been short runs and short passes, culminating in short runs like this one by Rick Finney in the end zone for 6 points.
One thing, Pat, I think a question that enters your mind is, do you think Michigan could be a little bit flat? You win, you defeat the number one team, Miami of Florida, a week ago.
I am sensing that from this Michigan team. They do seem flat. They don't realize what a good team Washington is. They're a very aggressive football team, and I don't think they realized how good Hugh Millen could be.
Jim Harbaugh needs some success, especially throwing the ball. He scrambled well with it.
He did scramble with the ball, but there's been good coverage by the Washington secretary. I have not seen too many wide open receivers, have you?
Nope, I haven't. It's 10-3, our halftime score, and college football on CBS will continue after this commercial message and a word from your local station.
CBS Sports presents College Football, sponsored by the U.S. Army, a place to be all you can be. The front-wheel drive Toyota Corolla sedan for 1984, now at your local Toyota dealer. And by AC Delco, the smart parts.
Ready to start the second half. 10-3, Washington with the lead. And statistically, we pointed out the time of possession. Total yards, look at the yards passing.
Well, that's surprising, too. Michigan thrown for 103 yards, but they only have 3 points on the board. Turnovers has been a key, too. Actually, we've seen the one turnover by Joe Kelly, the interception by Joe Kelly, converted into a touchdown by the Huskies.
Jaeger will kick off. Michigan won the toss to start this game. They waved off, and so they now will receive, and this man will do the honors. Jamie Morris, out of Massachusetts. He was the most valuable player in the Massachusetts All-Star game. And when Bo first saw him, he thought, he's got to be a wide receiver. He's not big enough to play running back, but he's proved differently. 10-3, the Huskies. Bring it out of there, and it might have been a bad decision as he's to the 15-yard line. That's tough when you have to run that far to get to the football.
Well, that's why you don't see too many freshmen playing for Bo Schembechler.
Harbaugh, we mentioned, did not have a good first half throwing the football, and Bo Schembechler now last-minute instructions, 15 yards.
And the interception really was the key. That's how Washington has scored. It's important. I talked to him a little bit yesterday. What he really wanted to do and felt that they could do against this Washington Husky defense is really throw those outcuts to Vince Bean, save sure passes, but they have not thrown the ball much on first down, and really then Washington has ganged up on second and third and long.
Bean had one catch in the first half. From the 15-yard line, Michigan trailing. Gerald White. White gets to about the 19-yard line. Good reaction that time by Peoples.
Well, you see Michigan, they really had actually bad field position. The one there at the last one surprised me when they ran out the clock, but they started their first two possessions on the 11, on the 20, but they really can't pound the football. You can't keep running the football against a very good defense like Washington. Bo Schembechler admitted it. He told us the other day he's going to have to throw the football, and he felt he had the man who could do it. Again, he's backed up, though, on the 19-yard line.
Second down, 7 for the Wolverines. Just underway in the second half. Harbaugh taking it. Being chased by Lewis, and the catch made by Vince Bean. That was an excellent job by Bean, who was able to stay in bounds, and that's the reason the scouts are so high on Vince Bean. A 9-yard completion, first down.
It's the second time we've seen nice footwork by Vince Bean as well. But if you notice the different types of philosophies, Michigan has thrown the ball downfield when they've thrown it. They need a safe, sure pass, really, to get Jim Harbaugh back some momentum. We saw, of course, Millen throw those fullback 4 times. A nice, safe pass. Michigan has to throw maybe perhaps some shorter routes for Harbaugh.
But that was a big completion for Harbaugh. That must give him some confidence. Gerald White, close to the 35-yard line. Leamber and Peoples again on the tackle. And this is a shocker in East Lansing.
Notre Dame lost last week to Purdue of the Big Ten and now trails 17-0, and that is just hard to fathom.
Well, you wonder about Jerry Faust down there. They've had some very good people there. If you look at recruiting polls and lists, they've had recruited very good people at Notre Dame the last 4 or 5 years.
Well, the South Bend paper asked for his resignation this week. Oh, nothing going on that play, and there's a penalty flag thrown. Tony Lewis, 95, stopped that play instantly as Bob Perryman ran into him. Very few penalties in this game. Don James, you saw him with a headset. He says, nothing goes on that football field. It doesn't come through my headset.
Is he listening to us, you think?
Yeah, I'm sure he wants our help. Illegal procedure against Michigan. When you're trying to get your offense going, you don't want that. And we saw an upset a while ago in the making. Michigan State leading Notre Dame and Vanderbilt leading Bobby Ross's Terrapins.
Well, Vanderbilt can really throw the football. They put receivers all over the football field.
And an illegal procedure on the offense.
What this
second
does,
down.
What this does now to Michigan makes it 2nd and 9.
It was 2nd and 4, obviously, before. It's a rundown. Now you're in a passing situation.
Morris is in the backfield along with Perryman. Still haven't seen Rick Rogers, who was 6th to the Big Ten in rushing a year ago. This is Morris. He's out to the 35. They're still going to be 3 yards short of the first down. Neamber and Peoples again. Boy, there was a lot of running room that time. They cleared him out. The offensive line that time did the job.
The cute little man, Jamie Morris. Now, Washington was playing pass defense. Remember, it's 2nd and 9. And Jamie Morris kind of hid behind some offensive linemen as he runs right over the official as the official gets knocked down. But a good, strong tackle by Tim Peoples, a free safety of Washington. You mentioned earlier the official is in a little bit of trouble there.
You know who that is? That's Bob Pickens. He played at Nebraska, but he played with pads. I don't think as an official he wants to get in that posture again. We have a man shaken up now. Fred Small has been hurt. Number 5, their veteran linebacker, which means they're going to bring in a freshman now to replace him. Bo Yates out of Lebanon, Oregon, will have to replace Small. And this is a very touchy spot for Washington. The outside linebacker, they do not have the depth they'd like to have.
Well, they have two freshmen backing up the starters, as you well know. I was going to make the point about Tim Peoples, who came up and made a terrific stop there on Jamie Morris. You know, UCLA has had those great free safeties, Don Rogers, Kenny Easley. They have compared him to him, and I've been favorably impressed with Peoples today.
He's a former wide receiver. They had so many wide receivers, they found a new spot for him. 3rd down, 2. Sim Nelson. He could not get turned on the football. Vesty Jackson defending. Now, Pat is a quarterback. You want to throw that ball, obviously, over the right shoulder. He was looking the wrong way.
Well, I think this was Jim Harbaugh's. Jim Harbaugh had Nelson open early. Now, you're going to see him, and what he doesn't do is actually he can pull up and stop and plant his feet, but he's throwing off the wrong foot there. He should have perhaps stopped. Then he could have drilled the ball a little bit deeper, but he actually threw the ball over the wrong shoulder and behind Sim Nelson. Harbaugh rushed himself a little bit.
Marty Robbins to punt. Did not get this one well at all. But he's going to get a roll. Benny Green tackled immediately at the 23-yard line. That was a 40-yard kick. Not artistic. It turned out to be pretty effective. 12:40 to go. 3rd quarter. 10-3. Washington with the lead. They have the football at their own 23-yard line. In motion goes Tony Rook. Jackson on the carry, maybe a yard. Mike Hammerstein. You know, that's an interesting story, Pat. In all our research we did this week, we were trying to get all the pronunciations right. So the Hammersteins, Mike and Mark, two starters. There's one of them, Mike. But one of them said, is it Hammerstein or Hammerstein? Well, the kids told us Hammerstein. Then he came back and said, yes, he says, I think it's Hammerstein. They don't even know how to pronounce their last name. Their dad's been called both, so we'll say Hammerstein today. 2nd down, 9. Hunt. I sense Michigan's intensity a little bit better defensively.
Well, that's just it. This defense, Michigan's offense is having its problems. What do? The defense has to come up with a big play, as they did last week against Miami. The defense has to force a turnover, or special teams has to come up with a big play, or the defense has to hold them here. Here is 3rd and 7, 3rd and 8. They've got Washington backed up. It's a critical time for this defense to bow its necks.
Crowd today. at 103,072, the largest crowd Washington has played before in a regular season game, topped only by the Rose Bowl. Hugh Millen back. Wide open is Patterson. Patterson is going to go. Touchdown, Washington.
That's unbelievable.
Who last year led him in catches with 38, just caught a 73-yard touchdown pass.
I am terribly impressed with Hugh Millen.
And you know, I don't think watching him last week, you came in with that impression.
You really did. He didn't really play very well against Northwestern. Don James was critical. There were some papers back in Seattle that questioned maybe that Sicaro ought to start this week.
That's been put to rest. Jaeger, point after. Bad snap, but Chandler got it down. Good job by Chris Chandler, their third string quarterback. It's 17-3.
Hugh Millen showed remarkable poise and composure and shows you how he can take a hit. It's a play action fake. Remember, it is a third nine situation. You have two linebackers coming right up the middle. He stays in the pocket. He gets hit hard from the outside, but delivers an absolutely beautiful throw over two defenders. That is the most difficult throw one can make. And of course, Patterson makes a nice catch and runs to the end zone. But here's the hit. Every quarterback knows you're going to get hit after the ball. And here's the look at Jim Scarcelli as he runs right into Hugh Millen's ribs. But he knows it's a touchdown, and he's pretty happy about this.
Washington now with a 17-3 lead. That was the ninth longest pass completion in Washington history. Jaeger will attempt this kickoff, as going back will be Jamie Morris. But Hugh Millen had the strong arm, and he needed it on that play. But you made a good point. He started out and got his confidence where he could throw the long ball. This one hit, and they'll take it to the 20-yard line. Next week, two outstanding football games. One of them from the Rose Bowl. Nebraska ranked number one, UCLA picked number one in a lot of the polls. They've got Bono, the quarterback. Nebraska trying to replace Turner Gill. And then Iowa. They're trying to rebuild their offensive line. Everything else is in place. All their defensive starters are back. And Ohio State, Mike Tomczak is kneeling now. I understand that leg's coming around.
He's going to play today. I don't know whether he's going to start today, but you have four teams right there who can put some offensive points on the board. Exciting weekend.
Next week here on CBS. From the 20, Michigan now trails 17-3. Harbaugh with protection, completion, and a real hit put on Morris. That hit by Tim Meamber. He's the guy that Don James has said so many times is the cog. They cannot lose this man. The Pac-10 Defensive Player of the Week. Maybe the best game he ever played last week against Northwestern.
Mike's collisions. He had three interceptions last week. You know, if he keeps his pace up, he's going to have 33 interceptions on the year.
What a mind. What a mind. Second down, five. Harbaugh to Morris again, and Morris comes out of there. He has a first down to the 40. J.C. Pearson, Tony Lewis made the stop. Pat, how many freshman running backs? Remember D.J. Dozier last year? We just keep running into freshman running backs who can play.
And small ones. Think of Alan Pinkett at Notre Dame, those little running backs that can hide behind the offensive lineman. See, the defensive lineman can barely even see Jamie Morris. All of a sudden, he comes out of nowhere, and before you know it, he's so quick, he's behind you. Actually, it might be an advantage being that small. I've always said that.
Kind of reminds you of Joe Washington from the size standpoint. First down at the 40. This is Gerald White. White to the 45. Kurkowski, 56 over there. So they give Morris a breather and come back with White. And they still have Rick Rogers. So they have three excellent tailbacks they can throw at you. Second down and four from the 45.
This drive, too, has been interesting for Michigan. It's the first time on first down that really they've been starting to do something. The first half, they generated no offense on first down and found themselves in passing situations where Washington could really tee off.
Michigan has their 6'8" former basketball player, Paul Jokic, in at wide receiver. Here's White again. White about a yard, maybe two short of the first down. Meamber made the stop. They're still being very patient, not trying to get it all back at once here, running the football.
Well, here's the kind of situation they're in now in a third and one, third and two situation, which a Michigan's offense should be in. Now, if they convert here on a first down, then you're going to have to throw the football. But I thought what they have to do is give Harbaugh a chance to throw some shorter routes, dump the ball to his tight end or a screen pass to a back, or dump the ball off one of his backs out of the backfield.
On a third and two. He's got the first down. Michigan, most impressive offense of the afternoon for the Wolverines.
Come November.
What party is he running for?
Now, this was the bounce play that we talked about at the very top of the show, and you're going to see Gerald White follow the block of his fullback on the strong safety. Remember, he kicked him out, and so he cut inside that block for a big, big gain in the first down. But remember, the tailback has three or four different options on the bounce play for Michigan.
Morris comes back in. White has 68 yards in the game. Morris 52. First down. Harbaugh, and a little too wide for Vince Bean. Vesty Jackson defending on the play. Let's check some other scores. North Carolina still leads Navy. That's at halftime. Wisconsin trailing Missouri. That's in Columbia.
Wisconsin has a good football team.
They concern Michigan. That's their next opponent. And Vanderbilt still leads Maryland 14-6. Wisconsin comes here next week, and Bo Schembechler feels they're the sleeper in the conference.
Alabama's still losing.
Second and 10 for Michigan. Being chased by Small. Harbaugh's in trouble. So Small with the second sack for the Huskies. He was out of there shaken up earlier, but he's come back again.
Well, this was the big concern of Bo Schembechler, was the protection of Jim Harbaugh last week against Miami, even though we won, as we look at some more scores. But that offensive line, if they're going to have an opportunity to win this football game now, it's third and forever, they're going to have to give Harbaugh an opportunity to throw the football.
Small is so tough to block. The defensive coaches say part of it is his stature at 6 foot. He's so quick with feet. He's been in there a couple of times in this game.
Tough to block.
Third and 19. Bean, the intended receiver, but again, too tall for him. And it's fourth down. Well, they had something going there for a while, and then the big sack. And Monty Robbins will come in to punt the football. Going back deep will be Danny Green. Green has been their big play guy, but thus far hasn't really gotten untracked this season.
We have not called his number much today, have we?
Well, he dropped a pass early. Did not catch a ball last week. Robbins, not very well kicked, but again, he's going to get the roll. Did they save it or not?
Yes, they did.
Yes, they did at the one. 57-yard kick at the one. Washington will have the football.
The officials have ruled this ball crossed the plane of the end zone and brought it back out to the 20. You can see Rodney Lyles, number 80, actually carried the ball into the end zone and knocked it back. It bounced in the end zone, so the officials moved it out to the 20-yard line.
And this crowd not happy about it, but obviously it was in the end zone. From the 20-yard line instead of the one, Washington. Rick Finney out to the 25. The last two times now that the Huskies have had the football, they've scored. This is Rodney Lyles, who is the Big Ten Defensive Player of the Week with three interceptions. They use him as a stork.
Well, they designed a defense around him. They named it after Ted Hendricks of the Raiders. They'll bring him at three or four different places. He's a specialist. He's a game breaker. And he put a lot of pressure on Bernie Kosar. He dropped back to coverage, picked off three balls last week.
And Ted Hendricks put some pressure on you through the years, and that's who it was named after. That defense, Wiles is there. He can't get it. Who's got it? Washington.
Oh, my.
Wiles had a real crack at a fumble recovery and somehow couldn't get on it.
We just talk about him being around the football last week so much and causing havoc. Historic defense here. This time he's coming on a blitz. Gets blocked out, but there was a mix-up on the pitch. The ball is on the ground on an AstroTurf. It kind of bounces around and takes his funny bounces. He can't get a handle on it. Looks like Jock Robinson, number 28, is going to make the ultimate recovery.
That could have been the turnaround play of the game if they'd had that. Now it's third and 13. Breaking out of there, but way short of the first down is Jock Robinson, so they'll have to get rid of the football. Tim Anderson making the tackle for Michigan.
And we talked about Rodney Lyles actually kind of being a specialist in historic defense. You're seeing more and more colleges do this. Rivera, the linebacker out of Berkeley last year, they did that with him. Jack Del Rio, the linebacker at Southern Cal, they're doing that with him right now. Rodney Lyles here at Michigan.
Ricky Huntley of Arizona, the way they moved him around.
They're creating specialists on defense.
Gant back for the punt from Cleveland. 6 minutes left in the third quarter. He hit a low kick, and Gant will have some opportunity to return it. Out across the 45 to the 47, the ball's fumbled. And the Washington Huskies have recovered the football. Three turnovers now against Michigan. That's Lonzo Hill, one over there. Let's pick it up again.
Goodness gracious, you think Bo Schembechler's a little bit upset? Tony Gant actually makes a nice little run. It was a low kick, the kind you return. Cuts it back down the sideline. He's really trying to help his team, obviously. They're struggling. The ball pops out right here. You see a host of Washington players right there, right in the game possession in the playing field, and they have first down.
Looks like Rick Finney was the guy that came up with it. Let's see, number 30, watching coming over here now. Yep, there he is.
Finney, yep, it is Finney. Right.
Finney got it, and it's at the Michigan 49-yard line. Two near misses from Michigan. Mellon, Danny Green, Cochran with a fine play. Brad Cochran, a preseason All-American, and he played Danny Green very, very well. You know, Cochran has had some problems. He actually left Michigan. He went to the University of Colorado for 6 weeks. They found out he had a chemical imbalance, and they treated that. He had such states of depression, and now he's come back to be the kind of football player that any coach would like to have.
Potential All-American. You, Millen, you can see him just oozing with confidence right now. It's coming on and on.
Trimble goes in motion. David Trimble, number 23. Second down, 10. Jock Robinson maybe got a yard. Tim Anderson has made a lot of tackles in this game. Made that stop from Pioneer High School in Ann Arbor. Boy, Alabama was trailing, and of course they lost a tough one last week. Georgia Tech has some real good skilled people. A lot of speed. Robert Levette in particular. Third down, 9. Wide open is spinning. And that'll be another first down.
Gary, that's the fifth time the fullbacks come out of the backfield and caught the ball for a first down. It was third and 9. It's a good, safe pass. You'd like to see a little bit more of this, perhaps, from Michigan's offense to give Harbaugh a chance to get some of that pressure away from him. But you see Finney, number 30, who made the fumble recovery, just slip out. Nobody's covering him. There should be a linebacker in that area or a defensive cornerback if you're in zone coverage, but nobody's there. It's a third and 9 situation. He catches the ball, turns his shoulders upfield, first down.
Don James has masterminded quite an offense here today. That fullback play, that's the fifth time they've completed one to the fullback. Here's Jock Robinson. Good reaction that time. That's Kevin Brooks on the bottom of all that. He is 6'6". He weighs 245 pounds. All Big Ten of a year ago.
You know, another way you can stop that fullback from coming out in the flat is having your linebacker, as he's blitzing the quarterback, really tie up the fullback, run right into him.
You know, you would think, and as good a coach as we have here, when you throw into the fullback four times like that, you'd made that adjustment, take it away from him. But it was open again. can see the confidence of Miller, can't you?
It's really coming on. He's looking downfield again, which in the past has been a pass.
On a second and 13, you called it. And wide open is Tony Roten, the tight end who missed last week's game because of knee surgery. He's been rehabilitating that knee, and he has a catch of 11 yards.
Here's the tight end, as you mentioned, Tony Roten. And another nice thing about Millen, he has spread his passes around. He's thrown to the fullback, the tailback, and now here the tight end for a big play. Now, Rodney Lyles, we talked about the specialist. He can drop in coverage. He can put pressure on you. And here he is blitzing, trying to get to you, Millen. Nobody picks him up, but he's a little bit late. Don James really seems to know when Lyles is coming and when he's dropping, making the right calls.
Third down and two after that 11-yard completion, and that's close to the first down for Robinson as he stumbles forward. Let's see where they mark it. Joe Gray eventually made the stop, and they're going to have to measure to see.
Very good offensive philosophy here coming in today by Washington. A lot of times when you see you get a team get ahead of Michigan 17-3 late in the third quarter, you're going to see them get conservative, run the football. What has Don James done? First thing he did after the fumble recovery was throw deep to Danny Green. He came back, ran a couple of off-tackle plays, a counter play, then he threw the ball a couple more times. Washington is a very well-prepared football team today.
That is a first down. Washington, if they would win today, Pat, they really have a schedule set up beautifully for them. They play Houston at home, then they play Miami of Ohio. They could go to November 10th unbeaten when they go to USC, and they do not play Arizona State and UCLA in the Pac-10. So this game is a big game for them to possibly...
And they're going to get better and better. We've seen the progress Hugh Millen has made in one week. Imagine him November 10th.
You spotted it on film, and if you look at this film after this game as opposed to last week, there's no comparison. Here's Robinson. They didn't get anything on that one. May have lost a yard. Dave Meredith, number 96, making the stop. And so it'll bring up a second down and 11. Vince DeFelice, number 90, comes in defensively for Michigan. Michigan does not have the big kids. They have the quick, the active team. Gary Mulder says we're an excitable-type defense. In fact, he says some of our guys are too excited.
Didn't hold the breakfast down last week against Miami before the game.
Second and 11. Vinny's one of those guys I don't think will ever fall backwards. He's always falling forward after the tackle.
It's interesting you mentioned it. I don't think he was tackled for a loss all last season.
Rodgers, DeFelice make the stop, and it's another third down.
Kind of get the feeling right here that Don James is trying to set himself up for a field goal to go ahead 20-3, which would take three scores by Michigan to beat them.
Jaeger is 5 of 6 in this early season. Green split out to the bottom. Gives to Robinson, and Lyles is there. The man they call Red made that stop.
I notice they ran the ball right in the middle of the field, getting ready for the field goal. A look at Rodney Lyles again. The three big interceptions last week. He's been coming hard today. Steps into the hole, takes on a couple of blockers, and really drives Robinson down to the ground.
So Jaeger, who earlier kicked a 25-yard field goal, will attempt a 38-yarder, and Chris Chandler will hold. Hit yet another one. He's having quite a year. 6 field goals thus far. Now it's 20-3. Jaeger, who has 2 field goals today, and his team now leading 20-3, will kick at the 1:39 mark, and Morris goes back. Jamie Morris. Well, Michigan's got to throw the football. Harbaugh is capable of that. If they can't go with Harbaugh, they do have another quarterback that they feel throws well, and that's Russell Reed, who is a sophomore.
You say he's their passer.
He's kicked that ball beautifully, hasn't he, away and making Morris run to the corner each time on the kickoff. One time he did kick it out of the end zone. So Jaeger is a weapon for this Washington team. From the 20, that's where Michigan will have it. Harbaugh is still the quarterback. Jim Harbaugh comes from the California background. And Pat, it's so interesting to me how you envision your position and what you want to be. Harbaugh was coach's son here in Michigan. He used to pass out hot dogs in the press box, but he always wanted to play quarterback here for the Wolverines. Going to the West Coast, I suppose that the California influence helped him, the passing league that they have out there.
I think the weather and just the attitude on the West Coast about throwing the football, the influence of the pro leagues out there, Don Coryell, Bill Walsh.
This is Morris. And, oh, he goes airborne that time, just close to the 25-yard line.
I've been impressed with Jamie Morris, though. He's a young freshman, and he's not very big, but he's been very, very aggressive. One Wolverine is not pleased about the way things are going. I'm sure Bo Schembechler is not as well.
From the 24, it'll bring up second down six. Gilvani Johnson, 26 now, has checked in at wide receiver. He along with Bean. Morris has 56 carries on six attempts. Harbaugh in trouble. That is the third sack of the day.
My goodness.
Reggie Rogers.
There's a strong safety blitz there, too, Gary, by Jim Rogers, number 39, came from the outside as well.
Tony Lewis help. He says, football is my sport. Yeah.
I'm not going to argue with him. I don't think Jim Harbaugh is either.
Rogers play for Marv Harshman of basketball. Now the Tides on the scoreboard, anyway. They miss the point after or kick two field goals. From the 15-yard line. Third down now, 14. They need a completion. Nice catch, beautiful catch that time by Steve Johnson. And that may be enough and is for the first down. And Johnson took a shot. What concentration. He's not very big. They list him at 5'10", but that's stretching it.
This is a fine throw. Top of the screen, Steve Johnson. He's going to get double coverage. There's a cornerback right on him, as you see, who's going to run with him. The safety is backing him up. And Steve Johnson makes a nice cut, and it's a beautifully thrown ball by Jim Harbaugh. And, of course, 26, Tim Peoples there is make the stop. But that's a third and 14 situation. Michigan does not want to be in those kind of situations. They need to be throwing the ball on first and 10, second and short.
That's the end of the third quarter, 20-3. Washington with the lead. College football on CBS. We'll continue after this commercial message and a word from your local station. We start the fourth quarter, 20-3, Washington with the lead, and head bench, that's the defense for Michigan. They've been battered up here today. At the 31, first down for Jim Harbaugh and the Wolverines. Peoples on the blitz, check that, Rogers. Harbaugh, I think, got on him. There's a penalty flag over there, I believe, or is that a piece of debris?
I think Jim Rogers got a hold of the referee's flag, too. But Jim Rogers, he is a wild man. He came in, we talked about him a couple times earlier. He came off the corner and was not going to be denied as we look at the third quarter stats. The real key there has been their turnovers. You see three turnovers by Michigan's team, and two of those turnovers have resulted in 10 Washington points.
Add three sacks to that.
Four sacks.
Yeah, with that one, that's right. The last one, Rogers just got his fourth. He just looked like a torpedo on that one. Second down now, 20. Harbaugh getting to White. Yeah. This Washington defense has been impressive. Ron Holmes, the All-American candidate. All 260 pounds of him made the stop. You know, Holmes really had some problems. He had a blood sugar problem. He lost his weight. He's lost all of his energy, and they didn't know they'd be able to play by the start of the season, but he's back now.
You see, there's no one better really at rushing the passer, but Bo Schembechler has to find a way to change the momentum here. This defense of Washington is just so fired up right now. He needs a big play by one of his offensive stars to get something going here.
Third down and 21. This may be it. Jamie Morris, and he's very close to the first down.
Well, if he didn't get it, they're going to have to go for it.
Rogers and Vesty Jackson over there. They're looking across the way to see if he got the first down. They're going to measure.
Looks like Jamie Morris injured his ankle there, too.
That's a blow because he has been the bright light offensively for this Michigan team.
He is so quick. but that was a short kind of pass, Gary, that we would have liked to have seen from Michigan most of the game. Nice safe pass, gives Harbaugh a chance to dump it off, let a halfback run with the football.
And give him some confidence. It is a first down.
The last three Michigan third down attempts, they've thrown the ball. They've picked up 19 yards, 14 yards, and 21 yards.
For the first time now, Pat, Rick Rogers has come into the game. He was their leading rusher of a year ago. He's number 20. He gained 1,000 yards, sixth in the Big Ten, had a high of 125 yards against Iowa. There he is. So that's depth. Got a guy who hasn't played yet. Gained 1,000 yards a season ago. There he goes. And he's across the 45 to the 46.
Well, if Bo Schembechler is going to run the football here, he's going to have to pick up 4, 5, 6 yards at a crack here because he's battling against the clock here.
From nearby Exeter, Michigan, he did not do very well academically. He was on the edge as far as making his grades, and that made Bo very angry. And so he's been in the doghouse, did not play last week.
Well, you admire Bo for putting somebody in the doghouse for that.
He said, I cannot live with a senior having grades that poor. Harbaugh. Mark Gray, the intended receiver, and it's intercepted. Jim Rogers again, boy, and what boy. A game he is playing.
That's the fourth turnover by this Wolverine offense. Here's the play. It's number 39, Jim Rogers is going to jump up in front of the receiver, Mark Gray. He read the play all the way, stepped right in front of him. Mark Gray really was not open. Another look.
There's a penalty
right
flag
in front of Mark Gray.
Yeah, we're waiting now on a penalty flag that was thrown. Let's see what it's all about.
Face mask, a 5-yard penalty. Defense.
So that means that Washington will have the ball at the 34. Four turnovers. But Jim Rogers, when you think about MVPs in the game, you got to look to him.
He's an emotional leader on that defensive football team.
12:49 left in this game. 20-3. Washington with the lead. Jackson. It's tough to win here. Let's face it. They've come in here. Pat, there are places where you feel there are jinxes. I remember you hated to play in Seattle against the University of Washington.
Well, every time you went up to play at Washington, it was raining, it was cold, and if you're a quarterback, you're always concerned about those kind of weather situations. But I don't know. Where else do you think is difficult to play? LSU is supposed to be
LSU
difficult.
LSU is supposed to be murdered. Tennessee, very difficult. This place is one of them.
Yeah.
But the jinx, you know, jinxes are interesting. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Second and nine now for Hugh Miller. Hunt, the other battering ram, out to the 38-yard line.
But although this is a difficult place to play, really, Washington has taken that home field advantage away by playing so well.
Ball control. That'll take your crowd out of the game. Remember that early drive of 9 minutes? They just kind of put the fans on their hands, and they haven't moved since. But jinx has developed. You have jinxes not only, Pat, in stadiums, but little things that I'm sure you had to do before you thought you could play well. Tie your shoes a certain way.
Superstition, Jimmy.
Is that superstition? Third down, six. Jackson hit initially by Mallory and then Lyles. There's Skip Hall, the assistant head coach, talking to the defense. Whatever he's been saying has been right.
He has had them lined up in the right position all time, all day long. As we said, you haven't seen too many Michigan receivers running wide open, have you? Skip Hall has done a very nice job.
We should highlight one guy on that Michigan team. You pointed this out. Mallory on that last tackle. He's been all over.
He really had, he had eight tackles, I think, in the first half. And it really has been. He is their emotional leader and has had a fine game.
Gant back. Remember, he fumbled the last return. Oh, what a kick this is by Cleland. And Gant will go out of bounds at the 21-yard line. 10:49 left. 41-yard kick by this man, Cleland. The Huskies are winning. Gary Bender with Pat Hayden. There's the time left in this game. Some of the emotion as Michigan, the last time they lost at home was in 1982. That was to UCLA, 31-27. Harbaugh to Sim Nelson, and he fumbles the ball. I think it's been blown dead, but that shows you again how that secondary is hitting.
Yeah, guess who knocked the ball out of his hands? That's right, Jim Rogers, number 39. He has been incredibly aggressive. And he did it. I guess that's why he's broken his arm twice.
Well, he's broken his arm. Now, remember early in the game where he got a penalty for hitting a guy late, but I don't think he knows when to stop.
How would you like to get hit like this, Gary? You're not a very tough guy, but try this one on. Oh, yeah. That'll make you start playing tennis or something.
I'll tell you what, I really take that personally. She said I wasn't tough. Here's Rick Rogers, and he's going to have to be tough. He's going to do that very often. Stopped at the 30. Let's check other games. Army leading Colgate. And as we said earlier, we'll have that Army-Navy game from Philadelphia this year. Vanderbilt still leads Maryland. And Rutgers, they played Penn State tough last week. Missouri in third quarter leading Wisconsin. Kentucky over Indiana. Indiana, of course, Bill Mallory, the new coach there. Tech is still leading the Crimson Tide. That's fourth quarter. Third down and one, and diving forward for the first down. That is Eddie Garrett, number 32, played his high school football in Milwaukee.
You know, coming into the season, Washington was picked as one of the favorites in the Pac-10, Gary, but there were some other very good football teams. UCLA, you mentioned, were picked by Sports Illustrated as their number one football team. Arizona State, although they played poorly last week, and of course, Southern Cal, I think, is still a question mark. So, but Washington, certainly he has proven themselves the last 2 weeks.
We mentioned they don't play Arizona State and UCLA. Here's Harbaugh on a first down. Broken up, he caught his own pass.
Now that's offense for you.
Do you ever do that? Huh?
Nope. Once a ball is deflected or hit by a player, anybody can catch it and advance it. This is exactly what happens. Harbaugh is trying to just hit the ball, a short little pass there to his wide receiver. It's deflected, pops up. He has really the presence to pick it up and pick up, what, 4 yards?
You never answered me. Did you ever do that?
No, as a matter of fact, I did not.
I thought you'd just get rid of the ball any way you could. That's a 4-yard completion to himself. That's Bean. He just didn't have a chance. He was hit by Rogers and Holmes. Both of them, huge men, hit Harbaugh and got up rather gingerly after that. Get back to this Pac-10. Don James said that he felt the team that brought their quarterback along the fastest would win the Pac-10. There's 7 new quarterbacks in the Pac-10 this year.
Well, UMillan has made tremendous strides from week 1 to week 2. So if that's the basis we're using that on, Washington certainly has to be the favorite.
7 new quarterbacks in the conference. That's really unusual. Third down, 6. There's a quarterback draw, and it's going to get a first down. Jim Rogers again. Harbaugh has really run the ball well today.
And a good call here by Bo Schembechler. 3rd and 5 and 6. They're having trouble picking up, protecting Jim Harbaugh. So what do? You run a quarterback draw. And that's precisely what happened here. He needed 6 yards. Goes back, looks downfield at his coverage. And the offensive lineman did a nice job of kicking the defense out, creating a big lane for Harbaugh to find. And it looked like it might have been a face mask there as well.
Jamie Morris is back in the game. That's good to see. He was shaken up earlier, but he's back in the game. Harbaugh, a receiver fell down. Mark Gray, the intended receiver, slipped and fell at the 30.
Now, remember, in college football, they say the ball has to be catchable before it's pass interference.
Did you think there was interference or a collision? I thought he just fell. I don't know. Mark Gray.
Boy, Harbaugh got popped there again by this defense.
Mark Gray was a big play performer for Michigan last year. He caught a 67-yard touchdown pass against Ohio State. Probably their fastest wideout. 2nd and 10 from the 50.
Double coverage in the outside receivers.
Harbaugh with beautiful protection. Catch is made. That's Bean. That's Bean at the 30-yard line. Ron Miles made the stop, but 20-yard completion to Vince Bean out of Southfield, Michigan. Very fluid athlete.
Really, the only offense they've had out of the passing game, the wide receivers for Michigan, has been number 25, Vince Bean. He avoids the first defender. We said there's double coverage. You're going to see a safety behind him come up. Again, right there against the sideline, makes a nice catch and concentrates and actually turns in and try to make a bigger play out of it.
Back to the live action, Harbaugh desperately trying to get the ball off. Steve Alford was there on him.
Harbaugh did a nice job of avoiding the sack, getting rid of the ball, so he's at least second and 10.
Might be able to see on Harbaugh there, he has tape on his chin. He received a blow on his chin last week, had to have some stitches, and I said, what's wrong with him? Bo says, we don't mention it. We don't even want him to know he has it. Just something to distract you.
Tough playing quarterback for Bo, isn't it?
Tell you what, the real Bo Schembechler, though, has a tremendous personality. And what a sense of humor. We've had a lot of fun here this week in Ann Arbor. Second down, 10. That was Bean again, and very fine play by Vesty Jackson, 27. Jackson, you might recall, broke that Arizona game open last year with an interception and took it all away.
You know, if you're a quarterback and you're faced with a defense like Washington where you're getting lots of pressure, you don't know what to do. Usually there's a couple of things you can try to do to change that pace. You can go on longer counts, change your rhythm. You can run some trap plays, some draw plays, some screen plays. But it's seemingly everything that Michigan has tried, Washington has been able to defend.
Third and 10 for Bo Schembechler. Intercepted. Did he hang on? It's Rodgers. He has been all over the football field. He's my MVP.
You can't vote yet, Gary. The game's not over.
I just was.
But you're right. Here's Sim Nelson, the tight end. He was open early. The ball was delivered late and allowed Jim Rodgers to drive on the ball and make the play. You've got to get the ball to the receiver when they're open a little bit earlier. Harbaugh, again, was under some pressure, though, which didn't allow him to deliver the ball on time.
Well, it wasn't an interception. The only thing that kept it from happening was the impact when he hit the field. Fourth down. Alford giving chase. He's back to the 50.
Well, he's going to have some time to throw now.
He's going to run it. And he didn't get it. That's a lot of running. And still not able to get the first down. Joe Kelly got him. And Harbaugh had Alford after him. Doubled back, got a block. And Washington will take over. 7:18 left in this game. Let's recapture what's happened in this game. In the first quarter, Jaeger with a 25-yard field goal gave him the lead, and then Bergeron, after a fumble recovery, kicked a record 52-yard field goal. Finney scored just before the end of the first half. It was 10-3. Then that brilliant Millen to Patterson pass from 73 yards. Jaeger added yet another field goal, and Michigan's got to score three times now to win. They don't even have the football. At the 23, get to Jock Robinson out to the 30-yard line. Pat, we talked about the Pac-10. Let's develop the Big Ten. If there's one thing the Big Ten has going for them, they have a lot of quarterbacks returning, the veterans.
And they have a lot of coaches like Bo Schembechler. Right? They do have quarterbacks, four of them, I believe, from California as well. But they have four coaches in the Big Ten, including that man right there, have over 100 wins. But after last week, the way Michigan manhandled Miami, you would have figured that Michigan is the favorite.
Seven quarterbacks returned in the Big Ten. And preseason, some of them were picked on the All-American list. Rick Finney, big, strong fullback, close to the first down. Rivers, Mallory in on the stop. This Michigan team must meet Wisconsin here next week.
They may be the surprise of the Big Ten, Wisconsin. Dave McLean's got a very good football team, although they're losing today, I saw Wisconsin was.
Dave was an assistant with Bo Schembechler for some time. Of course, Iowa's got the big game against Penn State today. And that was the first down by Washington.
This Michigan defense has been on the field seemingly this entire second half. Hasn't it seemed that way to you?
Yeah. Well, of course, in the first half, that first quarter, what was it? It was absolutely incredible how much they were on the field. 9 minutes on the first drive. Time of possession definitely has been in Washington's favor. Now Millen's wanting a timeout. 6:24 on this beautiful afternoon here in Ann Arbor. Ron Holmes and his teammates with the lead. Left, 20-3. Washington leads the Michigan Wolverines. And Washington, after shutting out Northwestern last week, is going to go 2-0 against the Big Ten, the way things look right now. Houston Cougars come to Husky Stadium next week. Green and Lonzel Hill will be split to the bottom of the screen on a first down from the 33. Motion and whistle stopping everything. Well, the Big Ten had really had an excellent Saturday a week ago. Purdue upset Notre Dame. Michigan upset Miami of Florida. And there's that game we just mentioned. It's a big one being played in Iowa. Hawkeyes with a 3-0 lead.
Dead ball, false start.
We'll have a report on that game throughout the day as Pat O'Brien and Ara Parsegian will update us from the studio in New York. And Sports Saturday, Thomas Hitman Hearns. Penalty makes it first and 15 for the Huskies. Finney straight ahead. With Finney and Hunt, you've got two battering rams. But to further develop the Big Ten, after they had that excellent week, they had three teams in the top 10 this week in the rankings.
Ohio State's going to be a very good football team before it's all over. They're going to get Tom Zach back, and he's going to be playing. Of course, Iowa's got Chuck Long with a strong arm, and I really believe Wisconsin is going to be a factor in the Big Ten race.
Keith Byers had a super game last week for Ohio State, the junior running back. Iowa's concerned about their offensive line, but wait and see. Here is Jackson. Make that Robinson. Robinson close to the 40-yard line at the 39. Garland Rivers made the stop. And 3,000 partisan fans here have not particularly enjoyed this afternoon, but it's been a big day for the Huskies. They made this long trip out here, and it's going to be a fine plane trip back. Green and Hill again, flanked to the bottom, third down and 5 for Washington. 5 minutes left in this game. And again, another whistle and a flag. Delay a game. They didn't get that one off in time. It's one of the few mistakes that Washington has made. Pat, I'm looking forward to next week. You and I will be in the Rose Bowl. Nebraska trying to rebuild after losing
offense.
That unbelievable backfield.
Well, if their first game was any indication, they've rebuilt.
Now they're playing Lou Holtz in Minnesota. We might find out a little more. Lou may wish he'd stayed in the Southwest Conference.
Lou Holtz spent a week with Tom Osborne last week trying to learn some things about his offense. I don't know if he did.
Third down now and 10 for Washington. Here's Robinson again, and Robinson will be way short. It'll bring up a fourth down. Anderson, and now Billy Harris, number 56, a sophomore. There he is, in on the tackle. He's one of the three nose guards they've used.
You have to wonder what a game like this does for both of these teams and next week's opponents. Now, of course, Michigan opens up their Big Ten season next week against Wisconsin, and they're going to have to emotionally pick themselves up off the ground here today and find a way to play Wisconsin tough. And, of course, Washington has a lot of emotion going forward in its game against Houston at home.
Cleveland will punt the ball at the 4:23 mark. Dan back, and he hit a beauty. Not able to go anywhere. I would say their coverage has improved since a week ago.
You're absolutely right.
45-yard kick. Absolutely no return. In fact, they lost 3 yards. We'll be back with the last 4:11 in just a moment. Two teams have joined each other here. Now that's a little technique there, the split screen, and the guys on the right are having a good day. The guys on the left You don't have to notice or have to even mention how they feel. Here's Harbaugh, and that's behind Sim Nelson, and Harbaugh really hit. Hey, we want to wish happy birthday one of our members of our crew, Patty Gorsuch, our associate producer.
Happy birthday, Patty.
She's what, 21?
I believe that's what you told us.
Now we're glad to have her with us and the crew as we get started in this 1984. Joe Assetti, our director, got him out of the NFL, out of New York.
And he loves his college environment, doesn't he?
I worked with Joe in basketball, and he's just as good, if not better, in football. Here's Harbaugh. And nice little lob pass. Did Bean stay in or out? Nope, he's out of bounds. Bean has done an excellent job of keeping those feet in. That time just couldn't quite pull it off. But Joe Assetti, our director, and our executive producer, Kevin O'Malley, is here along with Lenny DeLuca. I didn't know they let him out of New York.
Just occasionally, they take the leash off.
That's right. And our producer, who we've worked with for 3 years, Rick LaCivita. Other associate producer, Scott Johnson. Broadcast associate, Suzanne Smith. They're going to be with us as next week we'll be in the Rose Bowl. Of course, some of you will see that Ohio State game from Columbus. Harbaugh in real trouble. Tony Lewis giving chase. And he spots a man at the 30-yard line. Harbaugh's going to be a tired young man. He has run a lot today.
Well, not only that, he's been sacked 4 times and hit at least 10 other times after he's released the football.
That was Bean again. It's a first down. Miami of Florida leading Purdue. Purdue got an excellent job out of Jim Everett, their quarterback, last week to upset Notre Dame. There's Carolina. Their lead has been whittled away. Kentucky. What a job they did last year. White, Garrett in the backfield. Pat and Aaron in the studio, and they'll keep you posted all day long on what's happening. Here's Mark Gray, and Vesty Jackson is back there defensively.
I'm curious to hear what Era's going to say about the Notre Dame situation.
Ooh, yeah. You know, we shouldn't say this, but Era had picked them as a surprise team.
He will not appreciate that, that you mentioned.
We're just
that.
Joking you, Era, because I have such respect for him. But it did look that way on paper. We had Notre Dame. They have one line that averages about 290 pounds.
And they have some talented people back. Steve Berline, their quarterback, is back. Pinkett is back.
Got a lot of people picking number one teams. Another guy at another network thought Arizona State was going to be number one, too.
They had a tough time that first game, didn't they?
There's Jamie Morris. And stumbles and makes it to the 32-yard line. There's your time left. A convincing, very impressive win here by Washington. By Miles, Ron Miles, number 12, the most improved player as a defensive back they had in the spring, and that's the fifth turnover, the third interception.
Well, and Jim Harbaugh had 2 interceptions last week, and this is a very tough situation for any quarterback to be in. Everybody knows you're going to throw the football, but Bo Schembechler is going to have to find some answers, really, on how to bring that offensive line of his along. I think that's the most critical thing for Bo to get accomplished in the next couple of weeks. Here's another look at the interception. Harbaugh trying to drill the ball to Bean. Good drive by Miles, number 12. Actually, Bean was open, but he came from nowhere, drove hard on the ball to make a nice interception.
So at the 40-yard line, that's where Washington will have it. 3:11 left in the game. Finney. You know, Pat, I'm interested in one thought. Michigan has never been a passing team. All through the years, they've been an option team. They've had the Smiths, the Rick Leeches, the Wranglers. Do you feel that it just takes a long time to really change what you do well? In other words, he has Harbaugh, but do you know how to throw
well,
the football?
Well, actually, when John Wangler was here, they were not much of an option team. And if you remember, they won the Big Ten and actually went on to win the Rose Bowl. So I think those quarterbacks are kind of similar. But Bo says he's committed to throwing the football. He feels like he has to, but they just have to find a way to make that offensive line come along a little bit quicker than he had hoped.
That's stopped by Mallory, and we can't say enough about Mike Mallory. Bernie DeFeo that time carrying the ball.
As in most football games, Gary, turnovers are the key. Here you see Washington flawless there. Michigan turned the ball over five times, three interceptions, a couple of fumbles. At least two of those resulted in scores.
Plus the sacks, plus the near interception by Rodgers.
And plus, Michigan seemed to be in third and long all day long.
Less than 2 minutes to go. Millen giving off again. Are you surprised they haven't put another quarterback in? Give Sicaro maybe a shot at it?
What is Sicaro's birthday today? I don't know if you knew that.
I didn't know that.
I'm surprised. Not only is it Patty's birthday, but it's Sicaro's as well.
Paul Sicaro is their backup quarterback from Ashland, Oregon. He, along with Chandler, competing for that starting nod. We have a timeout with 1:50 left in this game. The score from Michigan Stadium, the Huskies 20, the Wolverines 3. Michigan got that timeout with 1:50 left. They trail 20-3. I want to thank Don Cannon, the athletic director of Michigan, who's been so nice to us. Bruce Motti, the sports information director. Mike Lude of Washington has made the trip out here, visited with him, along with Chuck Niemeyer, their new sports information director. Cleland to punt. Going for the corner. And Michigan's going to get the football just about at the 16-yard line. Our statistician, Mike Swanson, and our spotter, Steve Bear. Anybody you want to recognize here?
Not particularly. I'm sure my five children probably aren't watching. They're driving my wife nuts somewhere.
At the 17, Michigan with their last offensive opportunity. 1:43 to go. Harbaugh still in at quarterback. Garrett is the fullback. Pressure being put on, and he has to get rid of it. Tried to hit Sim Nelson, and Harbaugh picks himself up again.
Ron Holmes, all 260 pounds of him, was all over Harbaugh that time. It's been a tough day for Jim Harbaugh, but these are the kind of days you have to learn something from.
I'm curious, it's interesting you say that, because in a situation like this, I guess you get some confidence in yourself. I mean, he's 10 of 29. He's had three interceptions.
It's mental toughness, because the quarterback position requires that. You're going to have situations like this and days like this, and you have to fight your way through them to have the good days.
And there will be good days for this guy. He's a good player. Here goes Harbaugh. Out to the 25. There's nothing wrong with his running ability. Andy Fuiomo made the stop. Number 64, a former fullback, now playing defense. Michigan stops the clock with a minute 29. Harbaugh coming over. Coming up, stay with us. We have some boxing coming your way. Hitman Hearns, Thomas Hearns against Fred Hutchins, and then Woodward live from New York's Belmont Park. See Fit to Fight, who is the handicap Triple Crown winner. That's to follow this game. And of course, next week we'll have the Illinois-Ohio State UCLA Nebraska game on CBS. And this guy is looking ahead to Wisconsin next week.
You know, it's kind of interesting. Bo here has called timeout at the minute 29, losing 20-3. But remember, the first half he didn't call timeout when he had perhaps an opportune.
I think I said Illinois, Iowa, Ohio State. We'll have Illinois at Iowa the following week after that. We'll be flying in there to see Hayden Fry's club.
Chuck Long, they say he probably throws the deep ball as well as any college quarterback in America.
Big, strong guy. Owen Gill in the backfield. And they had all 11 defenders returning defensively. In Illinois, they've won their first two games over Northwestern and Missouri. Here is Gerald White. Fred Small had him, and White spins to the 30-yard line. That should be a first down. All right, the Chevrolet most valuable player for Michigan is this guy, Bob Bergeron, the field goal kicker. He set a Michigan record today, a 52-yard field goal. And at that time, it tied the game up three apiece. In a moment, we'll recognize the Husky MVP. Harbaugh, Cattis, Eric Kattis, 81, the backup tight end out of Cincinnati, makes that reception at the 40-yard line. They like Kattis. He and Sim Nelson give him depth. Okay, one of our two most valuable players for Washington, Hugh Millen. 13 of 16 completions, 167 yards, a touchdown. You said he had to do more, and he did it.
Well, he sure did. He rose to the occasion. Couldn't have asked much more of him.
That controversy has probably ended at quarterback now. Harbaugh off to Rick Rogers. Rogers has another first down out to the 47-yard line. And our last MVP, a co-MVP, and I think I gave this one away early. Number 39, Jim Rogers.
I can't argue with you there.
He had a fumble recovery, an interception, two passes broken up, five solo tackles and an assist, and he probably was a water boy at the same time. And a check in the amount of $1,000 will be donated by Chevrolet to each college's general scholarship fund to further assist qualified students in all chosen academic fields. That's Rogers that's shaken up. We'll return for the last 1 minute and 8 seconds in just a moment. 20-3, Rick Rogers still looking him over. Hope that's not serious. Pat, have you ever in your life been in a ballpark, 103,000 fans, and have it be so quiet?
It really has been remarkable because we heard so much. This is my first time into the stadium. I had heard so much how difficult it is to play here, how difficult it is for an opposing quarterback, an opposing team to come in among 103,000, but we have not heard much from them.
Pat O'Brien, Ara Parsegian watching this from New York, and they'll be updating us, scores, highlights. The big play of this game was that 73-yarder by Hugh Millen to Mark Patterson. Was that kind of the backbreaker?
It happened there in the third quarter, and here's where I think Hugh Millen really became a major college quarterback. He hung in there, he knew he was going to get a hit, and he delivered an absolutely beautiful pass. At this time, Michigan has not had the offensive firepower to be able to catch up.
Back to live action, and Harbaugh hits Kattis again, the tight end. Check that, that's Jokic, number 84, who's the former basketball player. He played on that NIT championship team of Bill Frieder's. He's 6'8". Bo says he has a thirst for the fray, so they think he's going to be tough enough to play football. There he goes again, and he needed more than 6'8 for that one. 55 seconds left, second and 10. Well, Harbaugh has been hanging in there. He got hit again on that play, kind of holding his arm a little bit.
It's been a day of really very efficient offense by the Washington Huskies and a phenomenal defense that really has been all over the football field. Second and 10 for the Wolverines. Harbaugh, Jokic, the big 6'8 wide receiver that we talked about a little bit earlier.
And so, Jokic getting some few seconds in this game, and basically that's going to give him some confidence. They may have to look to him more. That'd be a big target for Harbaugh. First down at the 15-yard line. This is Kattis, and Harbaugh hasn't quit this game at all. You got to give him a lot of credit.
He is very, team credit. Very much a competitor.
Bo's going to call another timeout. So coming up, the fight, the welterweight fight. Thomas Hitman Hearns defending his crown against Fred Hutchins. And then the Woodward and Futurity Stakes from Belmont Park. That's all to follow. And, of course, Pat and Ara updating games. This game starting early, so there's a lot of football being played after this one's over. And they will keep us surprised as to what's happening. And next week from the Rose Bowl, Nebraska, UCLA, and Iowa against Ohio State. And then tomorrow, we just continue our coverage. The NFL Today will start it all, and then Chicago unbeaten against the Packers in black and blue division. I've been around a lot of those games, and that will be very, very interesting. Forrest Gregg in his first year for the Packers. Mike Ditka's team unbeaten. Atlanta playing very well without William Andrews. And there's the other doubleheader games. Dallas 1-1.
It shows St. Louis and the Colts. Boy, St. Louis has been a pretty good team as well.
There's Rick Rogers leaving, and that really hurts. Boy, you hate to see that. He battled back to get academically eligible, and then he gets hurt in his first activity. And Bill Parcells for the Giants. Wichita State guy coaching the Giants, and they've won their first two. Bill Michigan Sim has no timeouts left. There's Harbaugh on a 2nd and 4. And White is out at the 3-yard line.
That's the kind of pass we saw Washington run so effectively with their fullback. They screen everybody out, have the back run into the flat, dumping the ball. But to take it to the fourth quarter where we see Michigan come out and give Gerald White, their tailback, a chance to catch the ball. He's a very good receiver.
He is. It's one thing that Bo told us, probably has the best hands of any of the tailbacks.
Caught 5 balls last week, I think.
At the 3, 1st and goal. This could salve some wounds if they could score here. Harbaugh on target. Bean had it for a moment and broken up, and we have a penalty flag.
He was interfered with. He was held.
Like J.C. Pearson over there defending on it.
He just held him.
You have a pass interference this year in the end zone. It comes out to the 2 this year instead of the 1-yard line. Haven't had that come into play.
Wonder how long it took him to think of that rule. That's pretty significant.
Yes, it is.
Prior to the ball being thrown against the defense, half the distance, 1st down.
Take a look at number 4, J.C. Pearson. It's going to be a quick slant into Vince Bean after the play-action fake. He was open. Right there, actually, before the ball was thrown, Pearson interfered with him.
Half the distance, that's probably about 8 inches what they got out of that. 1st and goal at the 2, Harbaugh. Oh, he hit on this play. 5 sacks for Washington.
Cool.
Timeouts left, do they? They don't. Bo would like to get in the end zone, but there's no timeouts. They stopped it with 7. I guess the officials are going to stop it. That's what they're going to do. They're going to have to snap it and get it going. They got 1 last crack at it.
Vince Bean has to turn and catch the ball, but he does for the touchdown.
I think you can build something off of that. As you mentioned, the young quarterback battling back, coming up with a touchdown pass. They're going to go for 2.
This is the play. They like to put Gerald White, number 22, in motion and roll Harbaugh to the right here.
Straight up the middle they go, and they got it. That's Eddie Garrett.
Bo keeps attacking, though, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
He's coming after you.
He's like a bulldog. He's got great tenacity. That was an 83-yard drive in 12 plays.
Here's the 2-point play. They like to throw the ball to White on this situation, but this time they give it to their fullback, number 32, Eddie Garrett. He's in for 2 points.
Pat, I just really thought that was interesting how you really picked up on the quarterback having that success. You've had days, I'm sure, where things weren't going well, but if you could finish strong, it kind of gave you something to head back into the film room with.
Well, I really believe that 80% of the position of playing quarterback is confidence and being mentally tough, being able to take the booze and take the criticism and taking the bad days and being able to fight through those things so you can have the good days. And hopefully Jim Harbaugh will have many good days ahead of him.
Well, he was 6 of 9 on that drive. and was picking himself up a couple of times. He took some real shots.
But did you see Bo Schembechler as well? He really wanted to get his offensive team, his offensive unit, into the end zone as well.
The turnovers were deadly, just deadly. Five of them, three interceptions. Slopey trying the onside kick. Touched by Washington, going out of bounds. I think they touched it. We'll wait and see. Brett Smith, number six, went up for it. So Slopey trying to come up with the onside, so Washington will have the football, and they'll have it across the 35-yard line. 2 seconds left. What a win for this Washington team. At the 36, the last snap of this game. Don James has just won another football game. It's his 77th win, and that is the end of it. The final score, Washington 20, Michigan 11. It was the turnovers, the five committed by Michigan, three interceptions, the outstanding fierce pass rush, and the arrival of Hugh Millen at quarterback. As Pat said so very, very well, that 73-yard touchdown pass, the backbreaker to Patterson, seemed to put Hugh Millen in the position that he is the man. He will lead Washington to what they hope could be a Rose Bowl. Thanks to our crew, they worked long and hard. We had the rain, the late hours. We know that you've enjoyed it, and we certainly enjoyed working with them. Pat O'Brien and Eric Parsegian will be in the studio to update us on other scores. For Pat Hayden, I'm Gary Bender. The final score here, the Washington Huskies, 2-0 with a 20-11 win over Michigan. Let's go to Pat and Eric.
Okay, thank you, Gary. I want to remind everybody that following college football today, we have CBS Sports Saturday with live boxing. Thomas Hitman Hearns returns to Saginaw, Michigan to take on Fred Hutchings in a World Super Weatherweight Championship battle. And then we have live horse racing out at Belmont Park. The Woodward Slew of Gold is challenged by Fit to Fight and the Futurity. And Michael Jackson is showing up every place else. Why not here? Welcome to the NFL, Michael Jackson. I'll have a story about that. We'll explain that on Sports Saturday. And Aaron and I will be here with more scores and highlights as College Football Report rolls on from New York City after a word from your local station. Stay with us.
This is CBS.
Welcome back to College Football Report. Pat O'Brien along with the coach, Jared Parsegian. The coach, Fighting Irish, are trying to battle back now. Michigan State now leads Notre Dame 17-10 in the third quarter. And coach, the Spartans were ready for the Fighting Irish today.
The same fellow that hurt Notre Dame a year ago, Dave Urema, right here passing the ball, throws it to Mark Ingram, a 52-yard pass, great throw and catch down to the 14-yard line. Then watch as Urema pitches the ball off to Butler. Watch the poor tackling by Notre Dame right here. One, two, three, four. Great running by Butler. I don't want to take that away from him, but that was not strong tackling. And of course, you see Faust didn't like it either. Again, Butler going to the left, a pitch out from Urema. And again, running through tacklers, strong, good speed, takes it in and scores again for another touchdown for Michigan State. They got off to a great start in this ball game. Notre Dame comes back. You see Berline back now. Pinkett slips out of the backfield. He pump fakes, throws the ball 40 yards. Number 20 right there, Alan Pinkett, for a touchdown. Notre Dame's back in the ball game, 17-10.
You know, if the Spartans hold on, there's got to be a lot of pressure on Jerry Faust.
There's no question about it. I think one of the problems is that you have such high expectations. In the preseason reports, everyone was predicting that Notre Dame would be one of the top-ranked teams, and I that included myself. And, of course, the disappointment and the relativity when you think that you're going to be great and things don't go well, you lose your opening game, it gets to be tough.
Now, you're close to the team still, and you talk to the players. How must they feel with all this negative talk about their coach all the time?
Well, it's got to be tough on them. I was on the practice field twice last week, and there wasn't a whole lot of energy. Of course, they were coming off of a loss. And psychologically, they're wondering. They're reading these things, too. You know, is it the coaching or is it us? Very tough situation for them.
Indeed it is, Coach. You know, Ray Perkins may be in the same in the same boat there as Georgia Tech has now upset Alabama 16-6. That's a final score. And the Yellow Jackets out there in Grant Field, they were going nuts out there, weren't they, Coach?
Well, it's quite an upset. And Georgia Tech and Curry, Coach Curry, here they are trying to get the ball in. This is one of the times that Bama stops Keith Gallatin. But this time, Curry orders his quarterback, Newberry, to pitch the ball out to Bob Lovett right here. Great blocking. Watch him take the ball right into the end zone. And they jump out to a sizable 10-0 lead. There's Perkins, of course. Now, Mike Shula back to throw. Season opening, runs the ball for a first down here, about 11-yard gain. Comes back again. Mike Shula, number 11, comes back, drops the ball off for the first touchdown. They get back into the ball game 16-6, but it was too little too late because once again, Lovett breaks through on a 43-yard run. Great running, great blocking. Look at those moves. And he takes it all the way down to within striking distance, of course, and he really put the nail in the coffin.
Let's give equal time now to Ray Perkins. We talked about Jerry Foss. What kind of pressure is he going to be under?
Well, I think it's a similar situation where he's replacing a living legend, a fellow like Bear Bryant, and he sets such a standard that it's almost impossible to duplicate it. But being starting out with an 0-2 record, that's got to be tough for the team, the coach, and everybody connected with the Alabama program.
You know, they haven't opened 0-2 since Eisenhower was president. And Bear Bryant was still at Texas A&M.
A long time.
Okay, out in Chapel Hill, North Carolina now leads Navy 24-19 there in the fourth quarter. North Carolina's Eddie Colson has rushed for two touchdowns there. The Mountaineers, 14 over Virginia Tech, 7. That's out in Blacksburg, Virginia. Wisconsin and Missouri, it's now 28-14 in the fourth quarter. Warren Seitz has had a good day. He threw for one touchdown and has run for another. In Iowa City, Penn State over Iowa State, 6-3 there in the second quarter there. Minnesota and Nebraska. Nebraska has scored now in the second quarter. The last year, Minnesota was beaten by Nebraska, 84-13. This is Lou Holtz's first outing for the Gophers. Miami of Florida, 7. Purdue now has overcome Miami, 10-7 in the second quarter. Alonzo Highsmith, 47-yard run. It's a big year for the Hurricanes for Alonzo. Florida State and Kansas now. They are in the first quarter. Florida State leads 7-3. And Vanderbilt in Maryland, there you see it, 17-14. They are in the third quarter. The College Football Report with Eric Parsegian and myself will return after this. Stick around. The coach is having a good day. Notre Dame just scored again and is now 20-17. Michigan State over Notre Dame. And coach, they're starting to come back.
Here's Berline, drops back and hits Milt Jackson on a 7-yard touchdown pass after a fine drive. And they're back into the ball game.
All right, coach, 20-17, Michigan State over Notre Dame in the fourth quarter. We'll keep you up to date on that one. Washington over Michigan, 20-11 today. Let's take you back out to Ann Arbor and Gary Bender. Gary?
Pat, a surprise here. You don't come to Michigan Stadium and win very often.
Well, Hugh Millen was sensational. And I was really surprised also with the Husky defense. Boy, they were all over the football field.
We talked to Hugh Millen, the quarterback, and mentioned that this game really has to give him a lot of confidence. Well, Hugh Millen, I would guess that this victory today on the road in Michigan Stadium has given you a lot of confidence.
Yes, last week I came out and I really didn't know what to expect and what with the crowds and so forth. And this week I felt a little bit more comfortable. I made my share of mistakes, definitely, and I still got to work. But, it felt good to get the win.
This is Pat Hayden. Tell us about the big play to Pattison, the big touchdown.
Okay, the play was designed to go on an in route to Danny Green. And they came up and their safeties were low. There was no deep help. I'm sure you know about that. And Mark Pattison was intended to just blow the safeties out of there, but they didn't go with him. So I just had enough time to get it off to him.
Pat, you feel that very play made Hugh Millen a Major League quarterback.
Absolutely. The confidence is going to be raised incredibly.
That's the story. Let's go back now to Pat O'Brien and Eric Parsegian.
Thank you, Gary. You know, you talked to Bo Schembechler this week. What was wrong? They weren't up for the game, I guess, huh?
No, they were up for the ball game. His fears were documented in that ball game because what Schembechler was concerned about, the defense, number one, and number two, he's concerned about the short passing game, and it really hurt him.
All right, Coach. Want to remind everybody, coming up next year on CBS, CBS Sports Saturday with live boxing, Thomas Hitman Hearns and Fred the Pumper Hutchings. Also, live horse racing out of Belmont Park, the Woodward Stakes, Slew of Gold and Fit to Fight, and the Futurity Stakes. And I'll have the story of Michael Jackson and the NFL, and you'll have to see that to understand that one, okay? Plus, we'll have an update of all the college football scores and highlights. Thank you for joining us on College Football Report. For Eric Parsegian, I'm Pat O'Brien. Good day, everybody.